Hello, this is Ed Mills with the state of Colorado. Who do I have on the line? They're shy. I got you.
They're not muted, are they?
No, shouldn't be. I am muted. All right, well, my name's Ed Mills. I'm with the Governor's Office of Information Technology, and we're going to go ahead and get started with the LTE overview and training. We, as you probably well know, we've been going around the state. We've been to all 64 counties and two tribes in the state, some multiple times. I think this is actually our third time in Gunnison. It might even be the fourth time. But anyway, we're really happy to be here, and we are going to we're going to leave this line open, and we'd ask that if you're just listening, go ahead and mute your phones. If you do have a question, you can go ahead and take the mute off and ask that question. We do want it to be interactive, and so if you have any questions for our speaker, please let us know. Speaker is Emil Ulbrich. He's from Signals Analytics, and they're the ones that have done some coverage analysis for us here in the state of Colorado. We're very excited to be doing these trainings in all the nine all hazard regions. And we are glad that you've decided to be a participant with us today. So with that said, I'm going to turn it over to Emil.
All right. Thanks, Ed. So I think just to introduce myself, I live here in the state of Colorado. I live up in Erie, right outside of Louisville and Lafayette, Colorado. So don't hold us and we're against it in Boulder County, but I love the state. My first time to Gunnison, actually. So travel all around the state and first time here. It was nice. I drove in last night and stayed at the Tamichi Inn, or
Tamichi Village Inn.
Yeah, Tamichi Village. Yeah, the town. So I stayed there. It was nice.
Just recently redone.
Yeah, yeah. It met the state per diem guidelines. So. Yeah. So a little bit about what you're going to do. This may seem like a deep dive, and it is for most people, but it's to gain a basic understanding of this new technology called long-term evolution, or LTE. You'll also hear the term 4G, and LTE is the first technology actually to meet the international standards for 4G. It's often been used as a marketing term. So we'll learn about the air interface, the RF, some of the messaging, the network components that are comprised of that, and understand really the public safety specific features. Because this technology is being used in your smartphone today, how does it apply then to public safety? How does it get utilized? What differentiates it from existing technology that you get in your smartphone? And what's similar? And then we'll do a comparison of existing land mobile radio networks. So if you're in the state, P25 network, the DTRS network, or have your own radio system, either VHF or trunked or whatever, we'll compare that technology versus LTE, similarities, differences, and then we'll talk a little bit about the planning that we've done under contract for the state of Colorado. So for over a year now, we've been working closely with Ed and his team at state to develop a network plan that can be suitable for the entire state. So at the end of this, it'll be very interesting. You'll see what was initially put forth as a plan to cover state of Colorado with LTE, and you'll see Gunnison County in there, and it'll be very interesting to use that. That one is a very stark contrast between what was intended to be covered and what will be covered, just due to the terrain issues and challenges you have there. So setting the stage, so we're going to talk a little bit about radio frequency and cellular basics. So when we talk about radio frequency, these are electromagnetic waveforms, and they exist in a range, and they're measured in hertz from 3 kilohertz to about 300 gigahertz, or billion hertz. And if you have an FM radio, when you tune into a station, 101.1 FM, that's 101.1 megahertz. So you actually know what frequency spectrum is. You have an AM or FM radio, you're actually tuning into those channels. So this is a chart meant to be an eye chart. This is supplied by NTIA, and it's an allocation of frequencies in the United States. The RF bands, We can take a signal, it can be voice or data, YouTube, me talking, and we can have AM, and AM is amplitude modulation, so we change the power that it's set. So an AM radio, when you drive behind a building or under a bridge or something, it fade out and then fade back in. And that's because the energy is getting absorbed by the building and, you know, you get into a fade. So we said, oh, we can be smarter. We can do FM. We'll send out the power constantly and we'll just change the frequency. So it'd be like you shaking a jump rope with someone and you shake it faster. The more waves you have, the more data you can shove on that bit. You can put a bit of data, you can put more data in the same amount of space as in a smaller frequency. So some bands are more conducive than other bands for doing communication. When we look to the technologies, we look at the power that an amplifier takes. So your phone, your cell phone, your land mobile radio, the amount of power that it takes drives how long your battery lasts, how long you can be in the field for. So in LTE, that becomes a big issue of a thing called, they call peak to average ratio. You have these peaks when you key up your radio, but your average is way down here. So we want to reduce that amount of time so the amplifier doesn't have to work that hard. So we'll talk a little bit about how the technology is conducive to that and allows that to work. So we have these different bands. We can put them in different types of channel allocation. The traditional way of doing that is FDMA. So FDMA is frequency division multiple access. And so you have different people talking. And an example of this is we could be here in the Public Safety Center here in Gunnison, and each one of us could go in a different room. You and I could stay in this room and have a discussion. And we don't want him to bother us. He can go in the other room and have a discussion. And so there might be 15, 20 rooms in this building, so we can have 15 or 20 conversations. That's great. There's no interference. You and I can talk, we can yell, we can scream, do whatever we want. It's great. Not very efficient, though. Come on in. That's all right. So it's not necessarily the most efficient, but this is how typical land mobile radios work. You have a discrete channel. I key it up. I talk on it. And I have that channel seized for the amount of time I push that button down and talk to it. It's effective, but not necessarily very efficient because you can't. The channels that you have are limited. So as technology progressed forward in the cellular world and in the land mobile radio world, we said, we can get smarter. We can do TDMA. And TDMA is we're all in the same room talking, but we take turns. So in a given amount of time, you and I have a conversation, and Ed has a conversation, and everyone takes their turn, and everyone's, you know, very nice and orderly and does that. But sometimes you have to speak really fast in order to get all your information out in that amount of time. So TDMA, we start sampling faster and faster, and so this is what is utilized in the next generation of P25 or land mobile radio. It will use two-slot TDMA. So that's often called P25 Phase 2. What's interesting is that P25 Phase 2, that technology, the TDMA technology, is based on a cellular technology, IS-136. The last IS-136 system was ripped out of the United States in 2002. That's how old it is. That's the next generation of public safety is looking to. So you see this big shift or chasm between what's happening in the commercial world and what's happened for public safety. The next type of technology is CDMA. So CDMA is code division multiple access. And they said, we can build really good receivers that can understand a lot of conversations at the same time. So now, this is everyone talking at the same time, but you and I talk English, Ed talks Swahili, you talk Portuguese, you talk French, and as long as everyone understands each other's language and is speaking at the same level, no one's shouting more than the other, you can understand. It's like being in a crowded restaurant, you kind of have this ambient noise level with everyone talking, but if the table next to you is speaking Spanish and the other table is speaking French and you're speaking German and no one's speaking English, you can basically all understand each other. And that's what CDMA basically does. So there's three different ways that we can send out information. LTE takes advantage of all of this, which is the first time that technology has done that. So let's talk a little bit about land mobile radio, just as a basis of understanding. So it really hasn't changed since 1933. In 1933 in New Jersey, you would key up a radio channel, talk to dispatch, they would then send that dispatch out to the cars in the field. And so that mode of operation necessarily hasn't changed from a technology perspective. There's been some advances and better radios and more reliable systems, and, but for the most part, it's now FM technology, like your FM radio, and it is utilized in much the same way. Because of that, public safety has had to operate on a lot of different frequency bands, those frequencies that we talked about. Here in the mountain range, a lot of VHF low band in the 400 megahertz, 200, 50 megahertz. Some of those systems are still operable in the U.S. and even in Colorado. The statewide DBRS system is in the 700 megahertz band or UHF band, and there's some in the 800, and then there's an allocation in the 4900 megahertz band or 4.9 gigahertz band. That's often used for microwave backhaul and things of that nature. Public safety resides right next to the allocation that the state of Colorado has. So this is a little bit of an eye chart, but if you remember back just a few years ago, we had all these UHF channels. So channels 52 through 69 used to be, you know, you tune in and get some, you know, UHF channel that someone may be broadcasting on. In 1995, actually, John McCain set forth a bill and said, you know what, we need more efficient TV, and we're going to come up with a new technology, and we're going to get rid of those channels and allow more high-definition TV and things of that nature to take place that don't have to take as much space. So this process for public safety, the allocation that we're talking about, started in 1995. Network's not even built yet. So it is, you know, the wheels of time grind slowly for the federal government. But in 2006, an auction took place, and they auctioned off all that TV spectrum. And now you have high-definition TV you can get over the air. And that's been vacated. And so a portion of that was sold to cellular companies like AT&T, Verizon, Sprint, T-Mobile, et cetera. But Sprint didn't buy any spectrum, but T-Mobile did. And then smaller carriers, if you have Vero Wireless or Union Wireless, they purchase spectrum. And then the upper portion, there's essentially two carriers. We have Verizon, and we have public safety. And then the public safety narrowband is where the DTRS system resides. If you look, there's two chunks. There's a chunk here and a chunk here. Same with Verizon, the C block, the C block. And the reason for that is that that's what we call FDD, or frequency division duplex spacing. You have a separate base station transmit and a separate mobile transmit. So my base station, my cell site, transmit in this band. My cell phones transmit in this band. That's just, they can operate in the same band or they can operate duplex space, and that's typically how they operate. So broadcast type technology or traditional landmobile radio was structured very similar to radio and TV broadcast. Not a lot of network design was necessarily done. You went and found the highest place you could, whether it be a bluff, mountain, whatever, you put your highest tower on there with the most amount of power. And that's because you only had maybe a few sites that you could deploy in your area due to cost, you needed coverage, maintenance, ongoing cost, things of that nature. So that's great for broadcast type technology and the cellular type technology. They want to limit that. They want to increase the capacity, so you want more users on there. So you put more and more cell sites in, make it denser and denser, so you can reuse those channels over and over again. So the concept of sectorization came about and cell splitting. So this is actually Lookout Mountain, if you're familiar with that, over in Golden, Colorado. If you look on the nice day, you can see all these radio towers that kind of sit on the ridge that system. And probably very similar here, you know, you have radio towers that are located up on the side of hills or mountains to take advantage of the terrain. So cellular antenna is very different than what's in the land mobile radio world. Land mobile radio world is mostly omnidirectional antennas. So that means the energy goes out equally in all directions. In the cellular world, in the 80s, they said, we can put these panel antennas, and you might see cell sites that are similar to that in town or on the side of buildings. And if you look at it from the sky, it looks like they're covering about a third of the pie, or about 120 degrees of area. So they sectorize that area, so it covers anywhere from 40 degrees to 120 degrees horizontally and vertically about 6 degrees. And then in the late 90s, they said, we need more capacity because more and more channels are getting used, more frequencies. We're running out of space on these towers. We can put these two antennas into one single physical antenna, but we can make the elements, we can polarize them, cross-polarize them at 45 degrees. And any idea why they did that? Just a thought. What they found out is, how do people, this is in the 90s, okay, this is, you know, in the early 90s, how do people communicate? Well, they talk on their cell phone. How do they talk on their cell phone? They hold to the ear to their mouth at a 45-degree angle. They realize they can gain, you know, anywhere from a 30 to 50% margin just by changing the antenna element around by the patterns the way people talk. So they were able to put more antennas, get better efficiency, and so you saw a real boost in cellular technology. You remember, we're moving out of beepers into cell phones in the time frame to get more and more efficient. Now, a lot of these physical antennas, you might see one physical antenna here, but this has, you know, one, two, three different frequency bands in it. So what used to take maybe six antennas in the past can now be done in one physical antenna. So you're seeing more and more of that happen. That's more prevalent in the front range. It's coming this way as you get more and more carriers come out here. You know, this is all cost benefit to them, right? So they look at that. If there's not a benefit for them, if they're not generating enough revenue, they're not going to do that. But most of those cell towers, the companies don't own those anymore. The AT&T and Verizon have divested most of that to third-party companies such as SBA, American Tower, Vertical Bridge, etc. So sectorization, this was mainly done to increase what's called the SINR, signal to noise to interference ratio. So I want to make sure that if I'm a user in this cell right here, that my signal is higher than the noise. What's the noise? The noise is all these other cell sites that are feeding into me because this is the guy serving me. And typically we've set up a grid. And we'd map out, let's say we take that map of Gunnison, we lay it out as a grid, it looks like a bunch of hexagonal grids, and we would place all of our cell sites. And so in a nice, you know, ideal world, everything's equidistant from each other, and it gets laid out perfectly, and you know, if you're in Kansas, that works great. Colorado, not so much. The real world isn't like that. Topography is different. You can get cell site leases in some place, you can't get others. So you have to make adjustments to that accordingly. There's a terminology that's used for the different sectors. They're called sectors alpha, beta, and gamma. So alpha is typically your northern facing site, and beta and gamma going around. Not that that matters, but that's, you may hear that term used by radio engineers going forward into this new LTE world. A major differentiation between an LMR system and a cellular system is this concept of handoff or handing over. So as we move away from a cell site, that signal to noise ratio changes. My signal from my serving cell site goes down. And this noise now becomes my stronger signal. So this is in miles, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So as I'm moving away from the cell site, as I get to about 4 miles away, let's say, my signal's starting to fade quite a bit. Well, this one's getting stronger. So now I'm going to hand off my data session or voice session from this cell site to this cell site. And that was a concept that was introduced in the 80s. And you may know where those areas are because you're like, oh, I just dropped a call. I have to call you back. You know, when you make this corner around this canyon, I'm going to drop a call because there's not a handoff there between the two cell sites. And companies try to get better in fixing those problems. Sometimes just due to, you know, you might be in some slot canyon or whatever it may be, or over a ridge, they can't get coverage there. But the intent is to seamlessly hand that over for both voice and data. So again, you see this alpha, beta, gamma sector, and we're handing off between these two sectors as we get around. And this is a big macro site, about, you know, 12 and a half miles. Coverage to the outside of that. Now that would be common in an area like Gunnison County. Not to have that. Any questions? Okay. So the standards that drive LTE. So I won't go into a lot of it, but FirstNet, the First Responders Network Authority, is the independent agency created under the U.S. Department of Commerce to represent state and local public safety at a national level. So their job is to build a nationwide public safety network. So they had a request for proposal, RFP, that just closed out on May 31st. The intent is whoever are the offerers from that will build out a nationwide network, and we'll talk a little bit about what that looks like here for Colorado. But they're, you know, they're not a network operator yet. They have to, you know, build all these cell sites out, put in radio equipment, get cell phones into your hands. How do they drive the standards to move that market? So the LTE standards are driven by a group called 3GPP, the Third Generation Partnership Project. This is an international consortium. They meet, you know, every quarter, and they drive the international standards. So this is a, you know, multi-billion dollar industry, you know, almost a $1 trillion industry globally. There's a lot of momentum there from the commercial side. So the Apples of the world, the Samsungs of the world, the content providers, they all participate in there. Public safety is a really, really small portion of that. They like to think they're big, and they do have some pull in that. But as part of that, you have all these different organizations. ADIS is the Alliance for Telecommunications in the United States. So our partner in North America is ADIS to get membership to 3GPP. But this is just a standard. So this is basically saying, hey, this is what your car tire needs to look like. This is what your engine needs to look like. This is what all the piece parts of your car need to look like. It doesn't tell you how to build a car. That's where GSMA comes in. The GSMA Association tells you, hey, this is how you need to build your car so it looks like a car. So when you have a cellular network, they define all the piece parts of the network here. This defines how you build your network, GSMA. So that's all the commercial side. On the public safety side, we have the Public Safety Communications Research Group, which is run out of Boulder, Colorado, as part of out of NIST. And so PSCR is playing a smaller role. Their conference is actually starting today in San Diego. And historically, they have driven a lot of the standards for creating LTE for public safety. In full disclosure, I helped start PSCR and used to work for them and worked for U.S. Department of Commerce for 7 years. I was head of LTE research and development. And so that was part of my job doing that. That role now has transitioned to FirstNet. This was before FirstNet took place, PSCR. But as part of it, they participated in a national group called NIPSTIC, the National Public Safety Telecommunications Council. So any agency can participate in that. There's no cost to that. State of Colorado participates in NIPSTIC. And what they try and do is they try and drive public safety related standards and be a consortium. So international chiefs of police and, you know, the fire chiefs and, National Emergency Numbering Group were all parts of that. NIPSTIC was in the early 2000s drove the common language initiative so that you got rid of 10 codes. So there wouldn't be confusion. What they saw after 9/11 is that for cross-border communication, the 10 codes maybe used in New Jersey were different than in New York. So when you'd have a call up from a dispatcher for an emergency, it created mass chaos. So after 9/11, NIPSTIC really drove that. So now most agencies use common language when they're discussing or have emergencies. So FirstNet has to collaborate with all of that. And they've just hired their first standards engineer. So they're just coming on board. They're coming up to speed to represent you. But the intent is, you, as an individual user, should be able to feed into this process either via through the state or directly to yourself. So that big international consortium, 3GPP, they created a group called SA6. So we helped create that. And SA6 is System Architecture Working Group 6. So these are all commercial groups, and down here is public safety. So it is good that they have official representation. And the main impetus for this was that the U.S. led this effort, but other countries said, hey, we think LTE is a good choice for us, for our next generation, for public safety. So in Korea and in the U.K., they have really taken hold of this, and they're going to deploy public safety networks before we are nationally. In fact, they're already in the midst of that. And as part of that, as part of that hunger and wanting to do that, if you look, the chair is Yana Claire from LGE, that's Lucky Gold Star, based out of South Korea. And then these two gentlemen are actually based out of the UK. So it's kind of, it's good that public safety is involved in that. I'm a little bit, I'd be remiss in saying I'm a little bit sad that the U.S. has not taken more of a leadership position globally. We could have, we didn't. We've surrendered that to other countries. Hopefully that will work on our benefit, we'll see. But their main goal in SA6 is to work on public safety specific requirements. The rest of LTE is going to get developed, so don't worry about that. What's the offset for public safety? So the biggest one is mission critical push to talk, and that's probably the biggest feature that they've worked on here recently. So release dates. So 3GPP, this organization, Third Generation Partnership Project, they have different releases. When LTE first came out in 2010 timeframe, release 8 was what Verizon initially deployed on. Current LTE systems, commercial ones, are on release 10. They have release 10 components in there. So when a standard is completed, like release 11 was completed in 2010, 6 years ago, or started 6 years ago, the standard was completed in 2013, 3 years ago. We still have yet to see fully compliant systems. Usually, it is about a 24-month period by the time a standard is completed until you see it on the street. So if you see any of the online magazines like Mission Critical Magazine or IWCE, you'll see a lot of press. Hey, standards are complete for public safety. And I say, good, that's great. That's the beginning of the beginning. You've created a standard. Now someone has to make that product. In 1999, the 3G technology that's used, WCDMA, was completed. And they said, hey, it's complete, no more, it's done. Within a year, over 4,000 change requests came in to enhance the standard in 1 year. So just because the standard is, quote, completed or frozen, doesn't necessarily mean that it's done. The primary release for public safety is release 13. This is the one that has the content for public safety. That was just completed in March of this year. So about 2 years out from here, about 18 months, 24 months out, is when you will start to see a real instantiation of hardware in mass. Now, just because it's in a standard doesn't necessarily mean it gets built. There's many things that get put into the standard that never, ever get built. We'll see in release 13 if the public safety-related features get deployed. So some of those features that have been worked on, these are all the things that that group SA6 said, hey, these are important. We want to work on these for public safety. The first one was high-powered user equipment or a high-powered phone. And we'll talk a little bit about what that means. Mission-critical push-to-talk. QoS, so that's quality of service class identifier, being able to differentiate your traffic from someone else's traffic, from commercial traffic. Enhancements to proximity service, actually this is where I need to move, this acronym goes down here, EMBMS. That's enhanced multicast broadcast multimedia system. So that's one to many. So that's how LMR works. I talk with one person and I broadcast that out to a group. EUTRAN and mission critical data. So we'll talk a little bit about each one of these. So high power UE. This was started in 2012, it was finished in 2013. What's interesting is that even though it was completed in 2013, one company made a prototype called Electrobit, and they've since renamed themselves Bitium. It's never gone into commercial production just because there hasn't been demand there from a public safety perspective. Now for an area like Gunnison and the surrounding valley here, this is actually a really, really important feature. And the reason for that is your cell phone normally has 250 milliwatts, or about a quarter of a watt of power. And the main reason that that is done is for what they call SARs, specific absorption rate. They don't want the radio waves to get stuck into your brain and cause cancer and things of that nature. So they've limited that power to reduce any cellular tissue damage. And that's been years and years of research that said, hey, This, now, there's a study that just came out that's saying, oh, it does cause cancer, and then very controversial, as was just published, I think, last week, hasn't been verified. But what's interesting is that even though the standard was complete, no devices have been made. Now, that when FirstNet gets rolling and starts deploying networks, vendors may do this, but this will show you what a high-powered UE, the difference is in coverage for an end user. And the intent is not to have your smartphone to have that amount of power. It's already bad enough. Your screen sucks down so much juice. If you were to put that into your battery life, it'd probably be about 12 minutes. So not very useful from that perspective. This would mainly be an in-vehicle type solution where you put your phone onto a cradle and then it would boost the power. Mission critical push-to-talk. This is the feature that they have been working on, a replacement or something to supplement push-to-talk services on landable radio. So very active in release 13. It was completed most of stage one, which was in 2015. In March of this year, they finished all these different features for security, for call control, whether you're on network or off network, floor control. So if someone has a channel seized virtually, that you get bombed accordingly. All the configuration management security were taking place. The first trial deployments of pre-mission critical push-to-talk are actually taking place in Korea with Samsung right now. So that's exciting. That's actually a good benefit. They'll hopefully work out all the kinks. But this is often sometimes misconstrued, and I just want to be very clear about this. This is just a standard that was completed. It doesn't necessarily mean, hey, go throw away your LMR radio right now. This will take some time for the networks to get built out until you have enough coverage. This is just a feature to replicate what's happening in the LMR world. My personal perspective is we've taken that 80-year-old technology and we're putting it into a smartphone. Doesn't seem like that's the right thing to do. That the public safety wanted, so that's what was driven into the standard. I think there were better ways to do this, but it's well down the tracks right now. So we'll see. This is a very complex way to implement communications because cellular phones, the way they work right now, they work in what's called a unicast mode. You and I have a phone call and we call each other. Maybe we can do a three-way call and we can have someone three-way in. But still, it's setting up a connection between the cell site down to you to me. And that takes those channels that we talked about in order to do that. To do a one-to-many, I now have to set up individual channels to everyone in the room. That eats up capacity in the cell site. In a broadcast-type world, I'll go back here. This EMDMS, this is meant to be one-to-many. And so that is meant to take an alert or a voice packet. I send it up to the LTE system, and then it broadcasts it out to everyone. And so this was the original intent of EMBMS was to do broadcast TV. It was meant to replace media flow so that you could watch, Fox News, or you could watch an episode of House or whatever the show was at the time. You could watch ABC, NBC, CBS on your phone. The problem was that what they realized is that takes capacity in your cell system. So the Verizons of the world, they initially were going to deploy this. They did a demo 2 years ago at the Super Bowl showing, hey, you could do this. Well, what's happened in the last 3 years is the viewing habits of consumers has changed dramatically. Fewer and fewer people watch broadcast TV when it's broadcast. They'll watch live sporting events like the NBA Finals are on now, or they'll watch the Super Bowl with the Broncos or on Sunday. But most people either record it on their DVR, they stream it on Hulu or Netflix or YouTube. And so because of that, not everyone's watching YouTube in the same content at the same time, or watching Hulu or Netflix or whatever it may be, or Amazon Video at the same time. So the necessity for EMBMS years and years, millions, I was in so many meetings to get the standard pushed out. Now I realize people don't really want it, So standard was created, may not ever get created, right? Just because viewing habits have really changed. Especially, I have teenage daughters, now, and Instagram and Snapchat have blown up and changed how they communicate completely. Text messaging has archaic to them. So proximity services, the other big feature was being able to do direct motor, device to device. In a LMR system, you can go into simplex mode and have one device talk to another one without any infrastructure in between. So we can go into walkie-talkie mode and have a discussion. Cell phones don't work like that. Once you drive out of coverage and you have no coverage, you can't make a call, you can't talk to anyone, it becomes a brick. So the thought was, well, can we implement something that can allow device-to-device communication? So that is now in release 13. To allow a, so we drive, let's say, up at Crested Butte, and we're in the middle of the backcountry, and there's no coverage there. If I'm on the system, now my devices will be able to communicate directly to each other as long as they're within close proximity. So let's say within a kilometer of each other, they should be able to communicate. So we can do voice communications, data, etc. This is really, really difficult and complicated. The first prototype devices are just on the street right now. I was able to participate in a trial in Bonn, Germany, and it's very early days, but very exciting. The commercial marketplace is driving this right now, and mainly because public safety, that market hasn't developed. So what they want to use proximity services for are flash sales. So right now, when you have your phone, if you walk into a shopping mall, the vendors in that mall don't know that you're there. So what they want to use this service for is they said, well, that's great for public safety. We want to use it to sell stuff. So you put in your profile, hey, I like Kenneth Cole jeans. I like Mercedes-Benz. I like, you know, this type of perfume or whatever. And you have a profile that's set up on Facebook or whatever. That gets broadcast out. You walk into a mall. Once you get within the proximity of that mall, then the mall, the owners of, let's say, you know, the discount shoe barn or whatever it may be, or at a Macy's or whatever store, they get your profile and say, wow, Mary's walking in and she really likes Kenneth Cole jeans. I'm going to send her a 20% coupon if she comes in within 5 minutes of my store because I know she's in the parking lot right now parking. So this is getting pushed in China big time. They're looking at this as a multi-billion dollar industry. So very interesting how a public safety concept now is getting utilized in the commercial world and taking and completely different concept for selling items. So let's talk about technology evolution. So I'm going to use audio as an example of the consumer market and the way we're able to adapt to new technologies in there. So when Ed was a young man, he used to listen to audio on wax rolls like this and make sure it wasn't too hot out. Then it moved to shellac, then to vinyl, then cassette tapes, then CDs, then MP3s, and now streaming. So as each new technology of audio came out, the public looked at that and said, wow, that's so much better than the previous generation. I'm going to forego the older generation, get rid of my LPs, get cassette tapes. All right, I'm sick of making mixtapes for my girlfriend. That takes a long time. I'm going to go CDs. And they're like, oh, CDs are great, but they get scratched up. Oh, now I have MP3. I have my iPod. Now iPod, that's kind of a pain to load. That I can now, well, I can get iHeartRadio. I can get Pandora, whatever, and stream it. So we've seen this. They're not rocking a Walkman. If they are, I don't know why, but they've moved to streaming technology. And that's been easy to do. People throw it out, they adopt it, not a big deal. In the public safety and cellular world, that's not the case. We've had some technologies go by the wayside, but in cellular, we've had to support 2G technology, this 2.5G data. 3G technology is very prevalent across the United States. And then we have 4G with LTE. We now have 5G trials starting. So in Austin, I'm supposed to be going down to the second trial here later this summer. And I have six transporters with Scotty and there's already talking about that. So What's interesting is that there's a lot of 2G out here in the front range still being utilized. AT&T, at the end of this year, 2017, is going to shut off their 2G network. No more 2G. So wherever you had, if you have AT&T or T-Mobile service, or you're in a GSM carrier, that service is going bye-bye at the end of this year. Gone. And that, in a lot of areas, that's the only coverage that you have. Verizon, on their 2G network, they have not made plans to do that, but they are very rapidly moving to that realm because they want to use that, those frequencies that we talked about, they want to use that for LTE because they realize, okay, we can do voice and data on this new network. The problem is sometimes the coverage isn't as good. You don't have as good coverage in a lot of rural areas. So that's happening, and FirstNet is, you know, aware of that. But this is just an example showing all the different kind of spider web of technologies that have to be supported. So a little overview of what of cellular technology. 1G, when it came out in the 80s, it was great. It used licensed spectrum, so you had an auction, FCC allocated that spectrum, I now own the license for that. I then can sectorize my network, so now I have this nice little hexagonal network and I can sectorize it, and then I can have mobility. I have a central switching office, and they can be connected to that central switch, and I can hand off between cells, and life is good. As we moved into the mobile data evolution, we went from analog voice to 2G. So then we started getting email notifications, or not email, sorry, voicemail notifications. That was the first part of data. Text messaging, sometimes news alerts were sent out. Then 3G pops up, BlackBerry comes up. Everyone's like, wow, BlackBerry's awesome. I can get email on my phone and push email. And I can get, you know, some basic data and WAP apps that are on there. And then LTE comes out, and now everyone, you know, the majority of the public have smartphones. I see smartphones on everyone's desk here. And people are using that not just as a phone now. I get my weather on there. I get my news. I keep connected with people through social media on there. I take pictures on there. About a year and a half ago, the number of pictures, digital pictures taken on cell phones exceeded all pictures taken since the beginning of photography. So you think about that. That's a lot of photography that's happened. And I think, you know, probably half those are on my daughter's Snapchat. You know, so it's just, it's fascinating how the small computing device has taken over. So there is a growing hunger and need to be connected and to have high-speed connectivity. That doesn't change for public safety. Public safety should be able to take advantage of those features that you're able to get commercially. So that's what we'll talk about going forward in the technology section. So LTE, long-term evolution. This is, from an engineering perspective, my nerd side, this is the good stuff. Previously, in previous technologies, you had the frequencies we talked about, those channels. You were stuck to whatever you had. You had, let's say, a 12.5 kilohertz channel for your land mobile radio network, and that's all you could use. And you get licensed for that. With LTE, it's flexible. It can do 1.4 megahertz, 3, 5, 10, 15, 20 megahertz wide channels. So depending on what allocation you have, you can utilize different channel size. It can operate in different modes. It can operate in the FDD mode, so this is frequency division duplex. That's where I have a separate transmit band and a separate receive band. And that's how most communications happen. Or it can operate in a TDD band. I have one chunk of spectrum, and I'm going to transmit and receive. I'm going to transmit, and then I'm going to wait, and then I'm going to receive and listen. That's how Wi-Fi works. So Wi-Fi operates in TDD. So if you've ever used Wi-Fi, if you're connected to the Wi-Fi system here, or you have an access point at home, you're connected to Wi-Fi, Wi-Fi operates in the TDD mode. It's very ubiquitous, relatively easy to implement. The issue is that if you are, let's say, at home and you're the only one on your Wi-Fi, your connectivity is pretty good. You bring in 30 or 40 people in this room and they all connect to Wi-Fi, everyone's throughput goes down because everyone's getting a little bit of a chunk of time here to transmit. Everyone's got to wait and then you get a little chunk of time to receive. And so everyone's taking a smaller slice of that pie, and it leaves less throughput for you. The other thing about LTE was designed initially to handle 350 kilometers per hour. The work now is completed to do 500 kilometers an hour. So this is about 300 and 330 miles an hour. So fast enough for most helicopters and small aircraft, definitely for rail, and definitely for high-speed chase, not a problem. Very low latency. So from an idle mode, from your phone doing nothing, to sending a packet, under 100 milliseconds. The difference between shoot and don't shoot is under 200 milliseconds. So this really allows for real fast, from doing nothing to sending a packet out. And then for really fast, it allows for video telephony, voice over LTE, real-time gaming. That can be then put to robot control, let's say for bomb disposal, things of that nature, drone control, whatever you can think of for public safety. So the other thing is, we have these different chunks of spectrum here. Well, let's say I own spectrum in different spots, which a lot of the carriers do. They have maybe some 700 megahertz spectrum, 800, 1900 megahertz, 2.1 gigahertz. They can now put these chunks of spectrum together and make it look like one big packet pipe to you. And they can do that on the uplink or downlink. And so they can support different modulation. So QAM, Q-A-M, stands for quadrature amplitude modulation. And this is just a different way to put data onto a symbol, which is then put onto that radio carrier. And so 256 QAM is what you get over, if you have digital cable in your home, if you have Comcast or someone like that, they're delivering your HDTV and all your content at 256 QAM. We can now do that over the air. So by the end of this year, in Telstra's network in Australia, they're going to take three of these 20 megahertz channels like this and aggregate them together. And they're going to have these new devices called Category 16 devices. And they're going to be able to do 1 gigabit per second on their phones. So we just got done, my other company that I work for, so I'm a consultant, so we have a commercial side, and we just got done testing Telstra's. Now, these are real numbers. We were getting 600 megabits per second driving around Australia, everywhere. And so that's faster than you can get in your house, probably faster than you can get into this building. So and they're upgrading their entire network, not just a couple cell sites to do 1 gigabit per second. And the drive for that is the consumer, you know, wanting more and more connectivity, being able to do that. So fascinating. This is not fantasy land. This is not far from the future. It's happening right now. So with that, do we want to take a little break, like a 10-minute break, or do we want to go through this? Okay. You want? How about we meet in 10 minutes, straight up at 10? Is that good? Okay.
You're doing a great job at making this all make sense.
Okay.
Very logical.
So we're going to take a 10-minute break. We'll be right back with you. Is everybody seeing the slide deck okay online? Yeah, we've still got folks in there. You can see it okay?
Yeah, I can see it fine.
Good. All right, we'll be back in 10 minutes. I got it at three, so I've had them.
Oh, you've had three already?
Yeah.
Oh, no.
We're going to get started at the top of the hour, so about 4 minutes. All right, we're going to get started here again, but I do want to give an announcement. We actually have, if you haven't been to our website, firstnetcolorado.org, that's firstnetcolorado.org. Not only can you find a copy of this presentation today, but you can see all the ones we've done in the nine all hazard regions. We're about halfway done, so we've got about half of those done. But we have just a ton of stuff on our YouTube channel. You can go in and you can see everything that we've done from the inception. You can go in and see all the presentations that we've done and all the groups that we've been in front of. So again, that's firstnetcolorado.org. We encourage you to go in there and use those resources. And if there's anything that you ever want to know, our contact information in there, myself, Ed Mills, my colleague, Kim Coleman-Madsen, and then our boss, Brian Shepherd, who is the single point of contact for the state of Colorado. So anyway, that's all I have to say, and I'm going to turn it back over to you.
Thanks, Ed. So this is the deeper dive section, and they'll pull out of that. So if you want to tune out stuff, I totally understand. But it's very interesting from an aspect of understanding how the technology works, the underlying structure of it, and how it can perform for public safety. So I won't spend a lot of time on this. I'll try and go through it pretty quickly. So we talked about those 3G technologies like CDMA and WCDMA. And what they would do is they would take a data symbol or chunk of data, and it would spread it across, let's say, 5 megahertz of spectrum. And the intent of that was that if you had interference, let's say here, it was spread across that really wide channel, you'd be able to recover that even if you had interference. The problem was you could only deploy it in 5 megahertz chunks. And sometimes carriers at 15 or 20 or 5 megahertz or 3 megahertz of spectrum, and it wasn't very scalable. So in Wi-Fi, they said, oh, we can do this thing called OFDM, orthogonal frequency division multiplexing. And what that meant is we'll have a bunch of these little carrier subcarriers, and we can puncture data in each one of those subcarriers, but we'll repeat it every so often, and then we can trunk multiple subcarriers together and occupy different bandwidths. So Wi-Fi can occupy different bandwidths as can LTE technology. So OFDM, if this was time on this chart and this was frequency, in a chunk of time, I would take a piece of frequency and I would say, okay, you user, you get that time. You user in the blue, you get this time. And you user in the orange, you get this time. That's great. Everyone, you know, gets their chunk of time to do that. But if you, let's say you're downloading Yahoo's page and you download the Yahoo page and you're just reading an article, well, I'm not downloading any content. And so I'm really not utilizing that spectrum very well. Other people could be utilizing it. So in LTE, they said, well, we can do this better. We can do OFDMA. So this is multiple access. So I can say, ah, you user here in the orange, you've downloaded your YouTube page, you're not downloading any content. I'm going to give this over to this user who wants to look at a YouTube video. They're going to get some content here. Ah, this user wants to check email right here. So now I'm puncturing in all those users very, very efficiently and doing it as quickly as possible. So that way I can utilize the spectrum as efficiently as possible. So that's the difference. Even though it's similar to Wi-Fi, there's some advances. And what's interesting is that the latest versions of Wi-Fi, 802.11ac, utilize OFDMA technology to be more efficient. And so if you go purchase a router, if you get an AC router, 802.11ac router, much more efficient than an 802.11n router. So this is the structure. I won't spend a lot of time on that, but what I do want to note is that in the downlink, so this is from the base station down to the phone, that's called the downlink, it uses OFDMA, what we just talked about. So that's a constant power envelope, and I puncture that user in for that amount of time, and then do that, so forth and so on. So each one of these is a data symbol. In the uplink, that's the transmit from my mobile device, they said, you know what, OFDMA, not very good at power efficiency because look at this, my power is constant here. It's really high, my peak to average ratio is really bad. So I am going to, during a
period of time, I'm going to puncture in these subcarriers here and be more efficient about that.
So a different way of doing it is to extend the battery life on your phone. It uses a different different form of technology or modulation to send the uplink data traffic as opposed to the downlink in LTE. And that was to extend the battery life on your phone so that you can look at your screen longer. So the smallest chunk of spectrum that LTE can occupy is called a resource block. And a resource block occupies both what they call the time domain and frequency domain. And a resource block has 12, 15 kilohertz subcarriers. So you take 12 times 15, that gets you 180 kilohertz. That is a resource block. That's the smallest amount of spectrum that LTE can kind of control and manipulate, per se. For public safety, we have 10 megahertz of spectrum in the uplink and 10 in the downlink. That's 50 resource blocks that are in there. Those 50 resource blocks consist of 600 of these subcarriers, so 600 of these subcarriers, and then 4,200, each one of these blocks is a resource element. So I have 4,200 resource elements. Each one of those 180 kilohertz resource blocks, I transmit every millisecond. So 1,000 times a second, I'm making decisions on who to send data to in each one of those 4,200 resource elements, and I'm puncturing in their data. So it's happening very quickly, 1,000 times per second, every millisecond, I'm doing a time to transmit interval. And so that's coordinated then between every single cell site in the entire network. So there's a lot of stuff going on in order to get your data out. This eye chart are all the different channels. We have physical channels. We have physical channels on the air interface. We have transport channels and logical channels. And this column here on the right is uplink and on the left is downlink. And these are all different. Normally, when someone would call like a radio engineer and they would measure something, they would look at reference signals and things of that nature. All these channels happen in the network in order to get you the data that you need when you need it. So, out of the deep dive into more of a deep dive. So, a gentleman by the name of Claude Shannon worked for Bell Labs, and he came up with a hypothesis called the Shannon limit, or Shannon's theorem. And in that, he postulated, if I have a channel, doesn't matter how wide it is, if I have this radio channel, I can send this amount of signal through, this amount of data rate through it, given the bandwidth of the channel and then the interference that I have. And what was started to be seen in 3G technologies in EVDO and WiMAX and WCDMA is that this green line is the Shannon limit right here. And then you have a 3 dB margin, it's this other green one. Is that 3G technologies were basically at the Shannon limit. So in the early 2000s, we said, wow, is this as good as we're going to get in a wireless channel? There has to be another way to get more data through here because people really want to, you know, check their email and maybe get video and things of that nature. So a concept of MIMO came out, multiple input, multiple output. And the thought was, if I have multiple transmit antennas transmitting the same data, and have multiple receive antennas, I can send out more data. If I can send out my data and shift it in time and frequency, and shift it out a different way, and then shift it this way and send it out, I can send out all this data simultaneously and not interfere with myself, and then reassemble it on the far end. So there's some complexities to that. If you I'll use Wi-Fi as an example. If you bought a Wi-Fi router, sometimes you'll see it has multiple antennas on it. It might have two antennas, maybe some of the later ones have eight antennas. There's one from D-Link that's got 32 antennas on the outside of it. That's the ability to send out multiple chunks of spectrum at the same time and then reassemble it. So when LTE first started out, it started out as 2x2 MIMO. We're now seeing 4x2 and 4x4. Sprint is doing 8 transmit, 8 receive. And the thought is I can now steer a beam towards a user or group of users and give them better performance in that specific area. So for an area like this, let's say up at Crested Butte, I would have my normal coverage, but then ski season happens and I know, oh, there's a lot of people at the lodge and a lot of people at this lift. I'm going to electronically steer my signals towards that to give them better coverage. It can also give you better performance. So different transmission modes, all these different transmission modes, you can have a single antenna, you can have transmit diversity, all these different things are supported within LTE, and there's actually more transmission modes. I think there are up to 12 different transmission modes now to allow all these different types of beamforming to happen. So as part of that, there's now multiple different channel modes, and they're supporting what's called 3D channel modes. And this is really being driven in urban areas. If you've ever been in, let's say, a high-rise building, once you get above, let's say, maybe the 20th floor in a building, you're overlooking the city and you're overlooking the radio network. You no longer necessarily have interference from or reduction in signal from buildings and topology. Now, a cell site that's over here and over here are the same distance to you up in the building. So that becomes more interference. And my ability to provide data to people in a high-rise building becomes more difficult because all these signals are coming in at the same level. They all look like noise. There isn't a predominant signal that is giving me service. So in LTE, they said, hey, we think we can do beam steering in this. We can do it in three dimensions. And so before, we used to have that pie, but it was horizontal in nature. Now I can do it vertical in nature. So you're seeing now antennas with 64 ports. I just saw a demo of one with 192 physical ports on it and one antenna array. And this is to cover a large shopping complex and apartment complex in Shanghai, China. To cover millions of users using a single antenna array. So you're seeing all these things are a precursor to 5G or fifth generation technology that are being as part of LTE to support large numbers of users in a densely packed area. Maybe not necessarily applicable to Gunnison, but that technology will be available here shortly. It's being trialed right now. So peak throughput, I'm going to try and walk through this in a simple way. So if we look at public safety, you have two 10 megahertz channels, an uplink and a downlink, 10 megahertz wide. If we assume we're going to do 2x2 MIMO, so two transmit and two receive antennas, we're going to calculate what our data rate is. So we know that there's 12 of those subcarriers in there. Each one of those subcarriers can carry 7 symbols of data, and we have those 50 resource blocks. And there's 2 time slots. So that gives me 8,400 resource elements. So that means each resource element can carry one of these modulation symbols. Well, a modulation symbol can carry 6 bits of data, and that's a 64 quantum. So we then take those 8,400 bits times those 6 bits, and we get 50,400 bits of data. So in 1 millisecond, that's 50.4 megabits per second. Well, now we have 2 transmit antennas. So in theory, we can get 108 megabits per channel in our public safety channel or public safety allocation. Come on in. So if we can get 50 megabits per second times 2, that's 108 megabits per second. About 25% of all the channels that we showed right here, that's all overhead. So that's messaging that's happening. It's not really helping you on your download or your video or getting any of that information across. So about 25% of that is overhead. So we take that 100 megabits per second, and about 25% of that is overhead. So we can get about 75 megabits per second. So in ideal conditions, when there's not a lot of people on the system, in my public safety system, I should be able to get 75 megabits per second in theory. In practice, what we see is pretty close to that. You're seeing about 73 megabits per second, 73 megabits per second in ideal conditions. In practical, driving around, getting 40 megabits per second, not unheard of. In the Adams County network, they're averaging about 25 megabits per second throughout the network in our testing. So that throughput, has a lot of different factors that fit into it. We talked about the signal to noise ratio here, how much loading is on the cell, so how many people are on the cell side. Then you layer on the top of that quality of service, and then maybe security, and then speed, and those all cause your throughput to go down. Right now, about 74%, I think it is, maybe 75% of data traffic is generated indoors in a commercial network. Most people are on their phones, sitting inside, they're not driving around, consuming a lot of data. If they are, they're talking on their phone typically. They shouldn't be on cruising, you know, Netflix, but some people do that. Needless to say, this is based on 64 QAM. Remember I said this is going to get updated to 256 QAM, so this will change from 6 bits of information to 8 bits. So you're going to see this data rate potentially go up in a couple of years with 256 QAM capability coming out. So priority preemption and quality of service. If you were to take a public safety system that we're anticipating that FirstNet's going to build, and a commercial cellular network, pick your carrier that you have here, I would say the differentiating factor that separates that public safety network from a commercial network is being able to prioritize public safety traffic above all other traffic. Being able to determine what traffic is important, being able to preempt traffic, that is what is a big differentiating thing between a commercial service. Otherwise, your commercial service provider would be fine. But if you're, let's say, at a game here at the university, or you're trying to make a call during the busy hour during ski season, you might not be able to get on a voice channel on a normal 3G network. You might get a busy signal, or your data rate's really slow on your phone. That's because you have a high concentration number of users, and you may be an officer, but you're not getting any quality of service. Now, you can get some voice quality of service per se, or not really quality of service, but prioritization with a guest card. So if you're familiar with guests at all, so you can get a calling card, or you can get a guest-enabled phone. And but all that does is that puts you into a waiting queue. So if the network is completely saturated, so let's say you have a huge land fire out here, an avalanche, and whatever else happening at the same time, and it's just massive destruction here in Gunnison County, and the network is overloaded, it doesn't necessarily, and everyone's trying to, you know, hit 911 or get onto the network, a guest card doesn't get you onto the network, but once you get on the network, it puts you in priority on the queue, so that you're the first one to then get a trunk circuit and get voice connectivity. In LTE, they wanted to be a little smarter than that and get you access priority. So LTE is the first technology, wireless technology, that can allocate the resources, those resource blocks we talked about, and we can allocate that on a application basis, on a needs basis, or on a user profile. And we have a lot of different levers and mechanisms in order to instantiate that. The first one's called ARP, or Allocation, Retention, and Priority. Then we have QCI, which is the Quality of Service Class Identifier. And within that, we can set the priority level of someone, whether they have preemption capability, preemption vulnerability, and we'll talk about what those are. We also have error interface control. We have a thing called ACB, which is access class barring. And this is kind of the night switch to knock users on and off the network. And we'll talk about bearers, dedicated and dedicated and default bearers. GBR is a guaranteed bitrate bearer, and non-GBR. So bearers. Everything that gets sent out of the LTE network is a packet data, and so bearers are used to provide that data service. A default bearer is used during initial call setup. They don't have any guarantee of bit rate, but they reserve the packets or the data flow for the duration of that call. Dedicated bearers operate in two different modes. You have a guaranteed bit rate bearer, and you have a non-guaranteed bitrate bearer. The guaranteed bitrate bearer has an associated ARP, which is the allocation retention priority, and quality of service, and it's delivered on demand. So you need it, it sets it up, and then tears it down. It sets a minimum bitrate, says, hey, you, this channel needs to support this minimum bitrate, and then sets the delay losses in there, and it also has a maximum bit rate. So it sets these thresholds and then establishes that TAM.
A non-GBR can also have ARPA QCI, and that can be set up indefinitely.
So bears, the reason this is important, it's different than LMR. In LMR, you have a discrete channel. When I have my device, I pick it up, I'm on the zone, I'm on the talk group, I key up that channel. It's keying up a very discrete frequency and channel and puncturing that in the system, and I'm occupying that channel for that amount of time. In an LTE network, you're on your phone, you may be on a voice call, you may have your text messaging up, you may have a web session up, you may have the weather channel up. You have multiple different data sessions. Each one of those data sessions can occupy a different bearer. So you have one for a voice bearer, you have a internet bearer for your internet traffic, maybe you have a bearer for your email traffic, you have another bearer for, let's say, text messaging, another one for YouTube, maybe one for video surveillance that you have coming in from the field, from the emergency support center. All those can be different bearers. Those bearers then can get different treatments for what they need. So if you want to ensure that your voice traffic goes through, it's going to be set up on a guaranteed bit rate pair. And the advantage of LTE, remember we said we're making the decisions every TTI, every transmit interval. So every millisecond, 1,000 times per second, we're making decisions sending that data out. That's happening much faster than your conversation, than your data rate. And so because of that, LTE samples the network. The network is saying, from the base station, your cell phone's here. I know what your signal strength is on your phone. I know how much data I can shove to your phone. I know the maximum threshold and I know the minimum threshold. I can set a guaranteed bit rate bearer up and I can guarantee that packet gets delivered to you. And it's kind of like an insurance policy. I set that up for a duration of time. So if you need to get through push-to-talk traffic, it can do that and set that up. So that's a big difference in LTE. It hasn't been done before. So ACB, Access Class Barring. This is the night switch. So right now, access class barring, the way it works is you are assigned an access class on your phone. And that's typically randomly assigned on your device. So on a commercial phone, it's typically, it's not your phone number, but I'll use it as an analogy. It's your IMSI number that's in your phone, it's on your SIM card. It uses the last digit of that number. It's a number 0 through 9. It's randomly assigned. And then through a hashing algorithm, you get access to the system. So not, everything's kind of evenly distributed. In LTE, they reserve access classes 10 through 15 for public safety use and for network use. So access class 10 is reserved for 911. And so this is to support NINA and next generation 911 and E911 calls. So you can pull a SIM card out of a phone right now and you can still dial 911. That's what this essentially does. So access class 10, doesn't matter if I have a SIM card in there or not, or if ACB is turned on or off, I'm going to allow 911 calls to go through. Access class 11 through 15. So 11 to 15 are for like a cell site tech. So if they're turning up a new cell site, they can reject everyone else's calls and only allow theirs through. 12, 13, and 14 are what are set aside essentially for public safety, social security services. Could be police, whomever, federal use, access class 12, public utilities, and this can be changed for whatever, and then access class 14, emergency services, fire, and EMS. So what you can do in a system, if there is a big emergency on the network, you can say only allow access class 12 and 14 to even access the system. Everyone else, you're booted off. Now, what that does is and there's a backup timer, so about every 90 seconds or so, every 60 to 90 seconds, a user can try and re-access the system, but as long as you're only allowing these users on, they're never going to get access to that particular cell site of that sector. It's not the entire network, it's just for that maybe cell site or sector that they're getting affected for. And so it's a very efficient way to boot everyone off the system. It's kind of a knife switch, like I said. It seems like there's a lot of granularity here, but there's not. It's cut and dry. Now, this is just for access on the system. If someone's already on the network, they're going to be on the network until they end their call and try and hit send again. So what this really does is the UE, this is your user equipment, your phone, he's going to say, hey, I want to get access to the system. Do you meet any of these establishment classes? Are you an emergency user? Do you have high priority access? If you don't, I basically say, I'm not even going to set up a connection to you. And then he doesn't take any resources on the network. Now. That leaves it for public safety to be able to make their call. That's a methodology that public safety can utilize. And at FirstNet has put together a very robust plan for quality of service called QPP. It's their QoS framework to do this end-to-end. So this is a little bit of an eye chart, but this is the QCI table, the quality of service class identifier, QoS class identifier. So initially, quality of service was set up here to do conversational voice, video, real-time gaming, etc. And in here, you would set up the QCI level here and set the priority level, and then a budget, so 100 milliseconds, and then the packet error rate, and then the service, an example of service that you would use. And so if you look here, the number one priority that was set up initially by 3GPP, the standards body, was to do signaling. I'm like, why is signaling the number one priority? Well, in order for your phone to ring, it's great to have your voice packets there, but if I can't get my signaling through to tell your phone, hey, you have a phone call coming through or you're trying to send a call, I need to make my signaling my most important issue or most important packet that I need to send through. So signaling gets put number one, then my voice is number two. Well, when public safety came onto the scene, they said, well, okay, that's great that voice calls are number one as a priority in your system. We want to be more than number one. We're public safety, right? This is for, you know, emergencies. So they set a priority 0.5. So 0.5 is actually higher than one. So this was created, if you look, this was created after, this is QCI 69 and 70. So this came, you know, 7-8 years after the standard was created. Public safety came in, so now they have a higher priority, 0.5. And this is for mission critical delay sensitive signal, mission critical push to talk. Now, when I key up my mission critical push to talk on my LTE smartphone, if I push that button, that signaling is going to get pushed through the system, and it's going to carry, my mission critical voice, which is at a 0.7, higher than here. So it's higher than even the signaling for normal cellular voice. So my mission critical push to talk now has the highest signaling and voice traffic over any traffic in the network. So the intent of this is that the packets that get sent through the network and get scheduled through all the routers and all the equipment and the radio access network side and on the device all have priority treatment given to that. And so that public safety mission critical push to talk becomes the number one item that pushes the network. And there's other things. Mission critical data is here, and that's given a high priority, and this or non-mission critical data right here. So if you're looking at CAD data or something like that that is important, but it's not necessarily needs to be where mission critical push to talk is, it's given its own performance guarantees. And these are real tight packet error rate losses, 10 to the minus 2, you know, 10 to the minus 6 packet losses on there. And very tight packet delay budgets, 60 milliseconds and 20 milliseconds. So really tight delay push on that. The other one's ARP. So this one's just a big eye chart. You can look at this later, but this is allocation, retention, and priority. So a feature that is in P25 is ruthless preemption, and that's the ability to boot a user off of a channel if you have priority. ARP is similar to that, but different. It's similar in so much as it does offer priority and preemption, but it's on a bearer basis. So each one of those bearers I've assigned, I can say to a particular group of users or application, I can give it a priority here 1 through 15, and then I can say, okay, is it a non-guaranteed bitrate bearer? Can I preempt that bearer? Yes, I can do that. Is it vulnerable to preemption? That means, can someone preempt me? Yes or no? Well, if I'm a public safety user and that's my mission critical push to talk, I'm going to say no. I don't want that. Guarantees bit rate error. Can I preempt? Yes, I can preempt other people as long as they're vulnerable. So I'm not vulnerable. So a commercial user right here, can he preempt? No, I'm going to say no. Commercial users can't preempt. Is he vulnerable? Yes, I'm going to preempt him if I need to. This GBR bearer, is it a commercial user? No. And is he vulnerable? Yes. So what that means is a commercial user in this particular scenario would be vulnerable. They're bearer. So let's say I'm a commercial user and I'm on YouTube and I'm watching YouTube and I'm using up a lot of bandwidth and a wildfire happens and the fire team needs to get access to the network. My bearer will get torn down potentially in a loaded scenario. My YouTube video goes away. I still have connectivity to the network, so I can still make a call. I can do other things. But that particular bearer, let's say for YouTube, gets torn down. And then now I can do a mission critical push to talk. Once that's done, I can reestablish my bearer and life is good. So it's only for specific bearers. And then you can do it on a per user basis change priority that way in preemption. But a lot of granularity, a lot of controls to do that. End to end, what this looks like, this is that I have to set up my on my device, my UE, my base station, my transport network, and back here at my core network, all these different filters, all these different QoS parameters, and that has to be set up virtually through the entire network. So there's a lot of coordination, a lot of effort that goes to make sure that an application to a user gets the proper call treatment. So this is going to be an ongoing process. Part of what State of Colorado is doing is they're working with FirstNet. FirstNet put out a call basically to all the state points of contact stating that we being FirstNet, they wanted to get information on local control of how to set this up at a local level. So who should get control of this? Because the problem is if you leave this in the hands of end users, everyone's going to turn their volume up to 11 and it'll be like Spinal Tap and then nothing will work. So you can't have everyone at 11. So this has to be managed at some level. Does that get done at the PSAP layer? Does that get done by on-site officer? Who does it? Is it done at a national level? Is it done at a state level, regional level? So what they're doing is they're looking for up to 5 users per state to feed into a working group that is then done regionally. So if there's anyone of interest from Gunnison or the surrounding counties or areas, they can contact Ed or they can go on the firstnetcolorado.org website and you can sign up for that working group. And they'll take more than 5. And they want to get input on what's important to you. How do you want to control this? What needs to be put in place? Companies like Motorola Solutions have said, hey, we want to make this simple. So we're going to just basically have a gold, silver, bronze button, and you push that, and then that'll push all these parameters to the network. Maybe that's what you want. But do you do that on a per-user basis? Do you do that on a per-application basis? Do you do that on a jurisdictional basis? There's a lot of different ways in order to control this, and what's important for public safety, what's possible, that's what they want to get fed into this working group. So, yeah, did they get that right, Ed?
Yes.
So okay. So multimedia priority services, this is basically a way of creating end-to-end functionality because it's just not voice, it's multimedia, it's text, it's video, it's a lot of different things. The public safety features in 3GPP are lacking and they're getting put into place. So new equipment that's coming out now will have this functionality, but there's still a lot of work to be done. Much of this priority and preemption requires an IP multimedia system. We'll talk about what that is here in the next section, but this is for the future. So NPS is an ongoing way to deliver end-to-end quality of service, not just in mobile networks, but to fixed networks. So like for instance, I'm on my cell phone and I'm talking to someone on this fixed landline, I want to be able to have quality of service to that landline. So what we showed was 2 users in an LTE network and I've created quality of service between them. what does it look like now when I have to go out to the cloud and then out to the PSTN, back to the landline circuit that comes in here? How do I instantiate quality of service for that? So this is pretty comprehensive, looking at an entire solution end to end. This is what happens when you power up your phone and you are a public safety user and you have quality of service applied to your session. So by the time you power up your phone and then get bars that appear in your screen and you send out data, all this messaging happens end to end in just a few milliseconds for you to start sending data flow on that. So a lot of parameters get set in the network based upon pre-provisioned pre-provisioning of that user and the application. So that's why it's so important, because each one of these network nodes has to get programmed up to accept what those parameters are. So that's why this working group is important. You don't have to understand all that. That's engineers, that's what I do. It's understanding what's your use case. How do you need this to operate for you and make it functional for your day-to-day activities, and then for emergency situations and for cooperative situations with different agencies? How does that work? And then this can get programmed in so that way when you power up your phone and you get your bars on your phone and then you can send out data and start your app, it can look like this and be set up appropriately. So, any questions? Comments? Quiet crowd today. That's okay. Network components. So we're going to talk about now what comprises the network for LTE. So a little bit about the architecture. We talked about user equipment. So you have multiple radio access technologies. You can support LTE. You can support 3G technologies, 2G technologies. But you also support Wi-Fi, Bluetooth. There's GPS in your device, multiple operating systems, Android and iOS, the Apple operating system, the two biggest ones. Microsoft is still on life support. They have devices out there. BlackBerry is still around. And then multiple different frequency bands that are supported. The other aspect we talk about the air interface, how it's spectrally efficient. We use OFDMA and MIMO to do that. The access network, so these are the cell sites that get deployed. The radio access network is all IP-based and it's decentralized. We'll talk about that here in a second, what that means. The core network. So the core network is now all IP. It's very scalable, distributed in nature. Prior to LTE, most cellular networks operated what was called a circuit switch network. You had to order a T1 or multiple T1s to that site. And typically, central office had to be within about 300 to 400 miles of a cell site. That was just due to repeater loss and delay. And so you had a central switching office, and then your cell sites interconnected to that. LTE kind of blew that up. So you take a Verizon, when they first launched their system in 2010, they went from having central offices, you know, maybe every 400 miles across the nation, to routing all of their LTE traffic to two data centers, one in Ohio, one in Texas. So you're making calls in Seattle or in Florida, they get routed to those two data networks. And they've expanded since then, but that was the initial deployment. Because it was all IP-based, they could concentrate that and they could scale it out accordingly and place their systems wherever they needed to be. Then you have a services core network. You have a IP multimedia system. And then over-the-top applications. Most applications that you get are OTT applications, over-the-top, so Facebook, Google Maps, et cetera, are all OTT applications. Prior to 2007, if I would have said, hey, let's go to the App Store, you would have said, are we going to Applebee's? What are you talking about, App Store? I don't know. It didn't really have a concept there because applications were owned by the carriers. So prior to 2007 and Apple launching their App Store, applications were developed by, or approved by Verizon or AT&T, and it was very much a walled garden. You had to know how the network worked, you had to know the screen size of the phone, and develop it very specific to that. After that, Apple really changed and did a paradigm shift and said, you don't need to know about that. I'm going to create an SDK software developer's kit, and
you just develop an app and we'll take care of all that. We'll create an API interface and you develop that. Now, you can have 12-year-old kids in Slovenia developing GPS location apps. They don't know anything about this network and how it works. And it becomes very transportable. So you have applications that are developed that you're using right now that are made by software developers in different countries that are on different networks. Maybe it was designed for T-Mobile's network, but it operates on Verizon's network fine. So you see a lot of utility in that. But it's really changed how the applications are delivered in LTE networks specifically. So the term you might hear FirstNet talk about, FirstNet Colorado talk about, is the EPC or Evolved Packet Core and the Radio Access Network or the RAN. So the RAN is the cell site. It's also called a couple of different names. It's called the EUTRA or Evolved Universal Terrestrial Radio Access Network, a horrible name. Cell site, base station, E-Node B, Evolved Node B, those are all the same term. So E-Node B, EUTRA, cell site, base station are all the exact same term. And E-Node B, like, why did they name it E-Node B? Engineers are not necessarily very creative. So when 3GPP laid out all the different boxes for the network, they laid it on A, B, C, D, E. And now this is the evolved node B. I'm not kidding you. That's how it was done in the standard body. It was not very creative or thoughtful on that. And it's become much more convoluted in the last, 15 years. So the E-Node B is, if you see a cell site and you see the tower, we talked about the antennas that are up there. The equipment that sometimes sits up at the top of the antennas, sometimes it sits at the bottom of them, that's the base station equipment, the radio amplifiers, the baseband cars, the transport network, it's all located there. The backhaul is called S1. So S1 is the connection between that radio access network and the evolved packet core network. It can be wired Ethernet, it can be microwave connection, but there's no more TDM, no more T1s. This is usually a 100 megabit Ethernet connection, typically, to a cell site. That goes into the security gateway, which is just a router. But then we have this evolved packet core. So everything in this gray box here is considered an EPC or EPS, if you want to call it an evolved packet core. Consists of a couple different things. The mobility management entity, the MME, the serving gateway, packet gateway, and HSS, PCEF, PCR, and SPR. So I'll talk a little bit about what those are. An MME is the mobility management entity. This handles the signaling traffic. So I have all my data. This is my E-Node B, my cell site. So all my traffic, my voice conversations, my YouTube, my Facebook updates, all that stuff, my PSAP, communications, whatever it may be, are going down this S1 interface. It gets then split apart into two different ways. My signaling information goes to the S1 MME, so that's determining where I am in location to what cell site, do I need to hand over to a different cell site, it's keeping track of me as I move through the network, and all the signaling information gets sent out via the MME. All my user plane data, the actual data that I'm interested in as a user, gets sent to S1U interface. So this is broken apart virtually. And the SMP gateway is basically a router. This is a packet router that the serving gateway serves all the cell sites, and the packet gateway goes up to the internet. So that's what they're basically two sides at the same point. The HSS is my home subscriber database. So this home subscriber server is used to be called an HLR in 3G networks. It's called a AAA in a lot of data networks. This is my data repository of my users. So this has where your user profile is, your name, your address, all that information, billing information, things of that nature. Are you paid up to date? Do you have access to the network? PCRF, we talked about all the quality of service in the network, what really sets aside a public safety network. PCRF is the policy control resource function. So the rules that I put in for you as a user, the quality of service that you get, the priority, the preemption, all get determined in this PCRF function. And then they get pushed into this PCEF and SPR. They control, this is policy control enforcement. This is the subscriber repository. These work in conjunction with the HSS and PCRF to set those policies, control the policies on users. Cell sites just on the radio access network, they come in a lot of different configurations. Typically, we talk about macro cell sites, so these are the cell sites you see out and about in the area. You can also have a boomer cell, and this is not really any different than a normal cell site. It's just sitting up higher, so instead of maybe being only 100 feet off the ground, maybe it's 600, 800 feet, maybe it's on the side of a mountain, and it overlooks a large area, has higher power amplifiers. That's all that boomer cells are, really. They've been using boomer cells since the 3G days in a lot of different areas here in the U.S., in places like in the Outback, in Australia. Then you have small cells. So in buildings like this, you might put a small cell to offer service within this building. They come in different sizes, femto, pico, micro. So a lot of cellular providers realize, oh, you might not have good coverage in your home. I don't want to lose you as a customer. So I'll offer you a home install micro cell. You plug it into your router at home, and it provides you a little bubble of coverage in your house. So AT&T does that, T-Mobile does that, Verizon does that, et cetera, and you can get these small cells. The services core network, this is the IMS core. So what was real simple, 102-year-old technology of making a phone call and saying, hello, Watson, are you there? LTE has made it incredibly complicated with the advent of IMS. LTE, when it was deployed, was initially a data-only network. Voice wasn't even thought of. And then they realized, oh, no, people still like to talk to each other. We need to add voice. So IMS was a solution looking for a problem for many years. And it's utilized now for voice over LTE and video over LTE services. It's also, it will be the gateway for mission-critical push-to-talk. So a lot of different boxes in there. I won't go into each one. But if you have any questions, you can ask me about them. So LTE, think about these huge networks like Verizon and AT&T and these massive data centers that you see maybe videos of. LTE doesn't necessarily have to be that way. This is actually a cell phone right here, and this is a little circuit card called Raspberry Pi. So when Radio Shack was around, you could go buy these, but you can buy them on the internet. There's actually a big internet company called Spark Fund based in Boulder, Colorado that sells these little boxes, and this is just a little Linux computer. And about 3 years ago, 3 years now, 2015, I think, maybe 2012, a bunch of researchers took all these components right here in the Evolved Packet Core and the IMS, so all these big massive boxes, and ported all the software to the Raspberry Pi. So they put the entire Verizon network on that guy right there. And so you could run a cell site from that small little system. And now that's been extrapolated to companies. And so Lucent Government Systems, which is based in Westminster, Colorado, they make deployable systems for special forces. You have LEMCO, OSHIUS, Polaris, General Dynamics, Motorola Solutions, Harris Corporation. They're making specialized solutions for public safety or for industrial or military use that are small, compact, man-portable. Nokia just deployed a man-portable backpack system this week at the Critical Communications Conference. So you see these tactical systems, you see deployable systems. So this is a cell on wheels that you may see here. They get pulled into events like the Harrison GD system. You see man-portable systems like this from Lucent Government Systems. This is a Motorola solution right here, which is part of their Guardian program. This snapped into the bottom of a drone, and it was a tethered drone. And then, so you drive, let's say with an SUV, you have a land fire, you have no coverage. You pull this out, you slide this out of your SUV. The drone goes up, it's tethered, so it has power, and it can go, let's say, 200, 300 feet in the air. And then it provides, it's basically, you've just created a cell tower, and you're providing miles of coverage then for your users in that area. So now you can have tactical deployments where maybe you don't have a terrestrial cell site deployed. Now you can deploy these solutions and provide
provide coverage where you need it, and relatively low cost and easy to deploy, single button push, and you don't have to be a technician necessarily to utilize that. The concept that FirstNet wants to do is what's called a multi-operator core network and a shared RAN. So you may have, let's say, operator one, let's say this is FirstNet, and operator number two, let's say that's Verizon. And they're going to share this E-Node B or base station, and they're going to transmit out of a shared antenna system. And this is just with an MME in there. These are basically tomato-tomato of showing that. A multi-operator core network is I have two different carriers and I share the core network and they have shared and differentiated services. So Verizon has a rural program that they offer small carriers to tie into their network. So I think there's 13 or maybe 16 carriers that are currently participating in that. So Panhandle Cellular out of Oklahoma and Texas, Bluegrass Cellular out of Kentucky, and handful of others said, hey, we have spectrum. We went and bought spectrum, but we can't afford to put in all this core networking equipment and everything. So Verizon said, hey, we have the core network. It's very scalable. We just add more servers and we can add capacity. You go buy a base station that meets our requirements. You go build a site in your location, Panhandle, and you can tie into our core network. You can offer Panhandle services and Verizon services out of the single base station. So that's a concept that FirstNet is considering, is that in this public-private partnership, this network may not be being utilized for public safety traffic all the time, so there might be idle time on the network, and that commercial user could use that for commercial services and generate revenue and offset the cost of managing the network. So this is a concept that will likely you'll see in a lot of the RFP proposals come forward. You'll see the term MOC and multi-operator core network. So if you followed FirstNet in the beginning, they've had three different versions. I think they're up to five now, different visions of the network. This has evolved over time. They've backed a little bit away from this, and now they're saying, okay, offerers to the RFP, here's our general requirements or our objectives that we want to meet. You go build the network that meets these objectives. We want to have this quality of service, this coverage, et cetera, for users. Go build that network. So they had a lot of different visions for the network. I don't want to say they've divorced themselves from this completely, but they're seeing what offers are going to offer them now. So it'll be interesting. By November, supposedly, we'll know who's offering the network to public safety and what that network architecture will look like. A big part of those transport. So the state is upgrading their state microwave network to support DTRS as part of that upgrade, that microwave network upgrade. The intent is to also potentially support broadband services in the future. A lot of municipalities have put in their own fiber networks within the state. So like where I live, there's the Brand Fiber Network. That's not a joke, it's called the Brand Fiber Network. It's the Boulder Regional Area Network. And so they put in their own fiber that ties into Level 3, which is a big service provider, one of the tier one internet service providers in Broomfield, Colorado, ties into CenturyLink. And so that's a municipal fiber network, heavily underutilized. So they have all this fiber sitting in the ground. They could be utilized for FirstNet. And so how do you tie in local, maybe microwave assets that are used? Maybe at a city and county level, you have microwave utilization. How does that tie into an intrastate or regional network and into a national network? So that's part of what FirstNet Colorado is trying to figure out, what that looks like, what are the rules for that? How do municipalities get compensated potentially for that? It gets complicated. How does traffic get managed? When a link goes down here, are these guys responsible for repairing that link, or is there some agreement in place, SLA? All that gets put in place, or needs to get put in place by the offeror, and how you connect all that. So it looks great on this slideware, making it really happen. How does a microwave site here in Gunnison that ties into the DTRS network that then will tie into a national network, how does it all get managed? And then how do you then extrapolate that, send to 50 states and six territories, and replicate that. NG911 integration. So integration with FirstNet and Next Generation 911 is very important. They, being FirstNet, have hired a NG911 coordinator, former operator. But being able to tie in all the ESINet and PSAPs, I think something that offers didn't really look at was the complexity in tying in all the PSAPs. Within the state of Colorado, we don't even have all the PSAPs tied in with each other. You have, you know, internet connections, but not there. There's not necessarily direct connection and coordination and dedicated facilities that tie all of our PSAPs together. The interoperability, the cost of that, different software and firmware versions, and dispatch consoles, you name it. There's all types of issues that have prevented that from happening. FirstNet wants to tie all of those together across the entire nation and then tie them into the wireless network. So how that happens, they put a lot of the onus on you, the end public safety users, to say, okay, PSAP, you want to tie into FirstNet, you want location-based services, you want to tie directly to the officer and get information directly to the officer. You, PSAP, have to meet our requirements. You have to upgrade your facilities to meet our requirements. Now, who pays for that, how it gets done, unknown at this point. But that's a great question. You know, we posed that to FirstNet. They don't know. They're waiting for the RFP responses to see what happens there. So a little bit device security and voice. So user equipment, UE is the term used for user equipment or your cell phone. It's just, it's again, synonymous with a tablet, whether you have a USB dongle, whatever it means, smartphone. That's all a UE with regards to LTE. You have a SIM card in there. So the SIM UICC card is called the USIM or Universal system module, and in LTE uses the USIM technology. A lot of different operating systems. So we're familiar with Android and iOS. We have BlackBerry, Windows, Linux phones, Firefox. If you use Firefox browser or Mozilla, Firefox actually makes a phone very popular in India. It's probably the lowest cost smartphone on the market. I think they're selling that smartphone with a 4-inch screen for, I think, right around $42 right now. So you're seeing that in emerging countries. These other ones, you've probably never heard of these operators: Sailfish, Tizen, Synogen Mod, like, what in the world? If you have a smartwatch or see someone with one of those Samsung or Apple smartwatches, it's going to be operating one of these operating systems here. It's unknown what the security of those are. They're very new. So your cell phone might be really secure, but hacking into that watch to get to your phone to get to the network may be very possible, unknown at this point. So we can try hacking into Ed's smartwatch there and find out. Cell phones, or whether it's a tablet or whatever it may be, UE, have basic components that are part of it. You have a front end module, which consists of an RF switch and power amplifier. Then you have this radio transceiver. That's the complete RF front end. And then you have this baseband processor. And that's basically your whole cell phone right there. So for each band, so I have 700 megahertz here, maybe I have an 800 megahertz antenna, 1900 megahertz, 2.1 gig, etc. I have to put each one of those bands with a separate antenna in my smartphone and have an RF switch and then be able to control that. So when you hear maybe a conversation, oh, what chipset is in your phone? It can be the RF chipset right here, or it can be the baseband chipset. Most of the time, we're talking about the baseband processor when we talk about chipset. The reason this gets important is that 3GPP, the standards organization we talked about in the beginning, there's over 44 bands of LTE globally right now. Way back in 2011, if you can think back that far, there are only 12 bands defined globally. This year alone, we have the AWS-3 auction. We have the 600 megahertz auction happening right now. So this is other TV frequencies that are being cleared out. So another 120 megahertz spectrum is going to be cleared out. We also have the 3.5 megahertz spectrum. there's going to be more bands added on here. We'll likely have probably 60 bands by the end of this year or beginning of next year, there'll be 60 bands.
Public safety has band 14 that we talked about in the 700 megahertz band, so it's right there.
Typically, that requires, you know, the regulator, the FCC or NTIA to, you know, define that band, and it gets defined globally. The reason this is so important, determining what bands you operate on determine the design of your phone. So your current iPhone, if you have it, supports, you know, somewhere, depending on the version that you have, between 16 and 22 bands. So there's 16 to 22 of these channels in here. There's 16 plus antennas in your system that it switches between, plus your GPS antenna, plus your Bluetooth antenna, plus your Wi-Fi antenna. And Wi-Fi operates at 2.4 gigahertz, 5 gigahertz, and 60 gigahertz. So you have three of those in there. So there's a lot of antennas and a lot of RF circuitry in your smartphone. And the reason I bring this up, FirstNet hasn't determined who their partners are. So they don't know if it's AT&T or Verizon or T-Mobile or anyone. So no one can design a phone. It can be band 14 only, and they can design a Verizon one. So there's some that support Verizon bands. There's some that support AT&T band. So I think we have, I don't know if we brought any Sonim devices with us, but Sonim is a manufacturer that makes a public safety device. And it's a hardened device that operates on band 14, but they can't support all the bands because they don't know what they need to design. That's a cost factor for them. So Sonim is one of the phone manufacturers. And that's an IP68 rated phone, operates on Android OS, but there's other vendors that make hardened phones than Sonim. They're a good vendor, but Motorola Solutions, Harris, Boeing even makes phones, Bitium, which is Electrobit, Samsung. That is one way to make a device. Excuse me. It's hardened, it's waterproof. This phone right here, it has it's a 3 millimeter thick Gorilla Glass glass on it. So on the you can hammer a nail with the front panel of this. So you can throw it on the phone and throw it on the floor, and it operates fine. And you take it diving with you. I mean, that phone is designed to withstand that. So you're in an emergency, you need to throw it through a window and break a window or throw it at a suspect, you can do that. That's what it's designed for. Is that worth the cost, though, to a department if you have to pay a premium for that phone for that user? And let's say they leave it on the top of their car and they drive off and it ends up in the snowbank, and then you're out, let's say, $1,000. Or do I go buy, let's say, a cheaper smartphone for maybe, you know, $200, and I buy a case for it, maybe from Lifeproof, or someone like that. So two different ways to crack the nut. One thing that Adams County did is, because the device market hadn't matured for public safety when they deployed their network in Adams County, so I may be jumping ahead, but Adams County, Colorado deployed a public safety band 14 network. So Adams County is by the airport, North Denver area. So they have a public safety band 14 network there dedicated to public safety. But there weren't a lot of devices out there, and they have literally a handful of Sonim devices. So what vendors said is, well, we can make a vehicular modem. So they made a little vehicular router, and CalAmp makes them, and it has a band 14 module in it. It also has a Verizon module in it. That installs in the vehicle. It provides a Wi-Fi bubble, secure Wi-Fi bubble around the vehicle, so it's got Wi-Fi in the vehicle. It also has wired Ethernet. So now the investment that they made as a jurisdiction into the Dell laptops and TouchBooks and iPads, they can reuse those devices. They don't have to get new devices. It uses band 14 to communicate from the squad car back to the network, but then within the vehicle, I use Wi-Fi so they can use their commercial phones that they have now in their pocket, or they can use their laptops and TouchBooks. So they didn't have to make a reinvestment in that. So it's not that you have to go buy a Sonim device, it's a great device, but you can also utilize existing technologies and use Wi-Fi to operate there. So we talked about the handheld devices being able to operate on the different bands. Vehicular mounted, so this is what we talked about, the vehicular router. This is a Motorola Solutions version of that. There's also the high-powered version. So this would be a vehicle-mounted radio high-powered radio to be able to offer better talkback capabilities in terrain that is not conducive to having terrestrial coverage everywhere. So in an area like Gunnison County, you might want to consider putting high-mounted or vehicle-mounted high-powered radios in there to give you better capabilities, better coverage for your network. We talked about the SIM card and what that offers. So there's the standard, micro, and nano SIM. The interesting thing, and this really feeds into this, people ask about security. If you look like in on this building, it has a Hughes ID reader. So if you, once they activate the ID badge readers, you'd have your badge, you run it up to the door, it verifies that that's you, and then unlocks the door and lets you in. So that's real common in business buildings, public safety buildings. That technology, there's a SIM card actually sitting in your device, the components of a SIM card sitting in that device. The banking industry, when they looked at making secure banking, they looked at what's the most secure industry out there. It's the mobile industry. So they utilize SIM card technology in their bank verifications. So the SIM card technology, very secure. It doesn't mean it can't be hacked. GSM was just hacked a few years ago, but it had been in existence for, I think, 22 years before it has been hacked. So they took lessons learned from that when they deployed LTE. Said, hey, we want to have one key. We'll have, I think, 8 revolving keys now. So it keeps changing, but just rest assured that the most secure communication system around. We talked a little bit about LTE Direct. I won't spend a lot of time, but this is the walkie-talkie mode on the devices. So in a normal cellular system, I set up my phone call with the cell site. It goes through the evolved packet core, then out the other cell site, and then we have our next conversation. In proximity mode or direct communication, I talk device to device, and no cell site is involved in there. Or I can have a relay mode, and I don't even talk to the network. And where this becomes applicable is, let's say you have an event. Let's say there's some ski event out at Crested Butte, and you have to provide coverage for that. Well, the network could get saturated, and you might not be able to have communication. Well, now you go off network and you can communicate with users that are in that local proximity. Or let's say you have a wildfire and you need to communicate with people. You could have that capability. So that's in, it was part of Release 12. Release 13 brings a lot of features. Release 14 is where the public safety communication features really come into play. So it's a ways off, but it is in the standards right now. Security, we've talked about that. The big difference, this is an area, we'll talk a little bit in the comparison with LMR, but it offers AES encryption. It is only 128-bit encryption, so for 256-bit encryption, not offered yet on network side, but you can use a VPN to support that. So voice options. LTE didn't have voice initially built into it, and now it does. But you've always been able to support VoIP, so if you use Skype or Fiber or something along that, or VoxDocs, you could very feature-rich, so you can do the video on Skype, you can do text messaging, voice, but there's no quality of service, there's no interoperability, so if Ed and I are on Skype and you're on VoxDocs or Fiber, you can't necessarily join our conversation, you have to be on Skype. So that was one of the issues. Voice over LTE, this is being deployed by the 3 national carriers now. It offers a quality of service. It's fully interoperable with all other switch circuit services. Offers roaming and inter-carrier operation. So that's great, but that's carrier deployed. So those are the two kind of main telephony voice options. Then you look at push-to-talk. Right now, there's over 15 over-the-top vendors. And I think there's close to 90 applications that you can get on the Android store that all offer push-to-talk. So you can download lots of applications that do push-to-talk. And some of them are pretty innovative. And some of them mean interoperate with LMR. So you can get a donor radio, plug it into a VoIP server, and you can have interoperability. But there's no quality of service in a lot of the channel selection features. Floor control, security mechanisms aren't available on those OTTs. Doesn't mean they couldn't be. They're working to get there. The big one is mission critical push to talk. So this is that work item we talked about being deployed in trial in South Korea right now, has full interoperability with P25, with quality of service.
This is very complicated to deploy, and it's unknown what the price will be on that. And then we talked about the direct mode, that's the device to device. And right now, the device market is almost not existent, very nascent, early days on that. So, quick comparison on LTE and LMR. This is put together by DHS OEC. I just reused a lot of it right here. So in the green, we have land mobile radio, or P25 as we know it today, and then in the blue, we have LTE. So P25, we can get some location from it, we can get some short text messaging if you have data hooked up to it, mainly a voice system though. The data rate, very slow, 9.6 kilobits per second, 9600 baud, I should say, as opposed to LTE. It's a flat IP network designed to run, you know, the entire gamut of internet applications. If you look at the channel allocation, P25, 12.5 kilohertz channels. If you're going to narrow banding, it's 6.25. But those are discrete channels. In LTE, we're in the time domain and frequency domain. We spend a big chunk of time talking about the efficiency of LTE and how you can send out data that in that methodology. Figure of merit. So in an LMR network, and one of the things that fascinated me when I came into this industry about 10 years ago on the public safety side was the prior, in my prior life on the commercial side, we had all these different metrics and data that we would gather to measure the performance of the network, the signal strength of the network, the noise ratio, a bit error rate, all the data we capture off of the phone to ensure that we have good performance on it. When I looked at LMR networks, I said, oh, we do delivered audio quality. And so DAQ was, it was kind of, can you hear me now? And then it was rated on a MOS score of 1 to 5. And it was perception based, just not very accurate. Whereas in LTE, we can look at throughput in bits per second. We can look at application data layer and quality of service. We can have very little packet loss. Throughput, again, the throughput on LMR, not very high. It wasn't designed for that, designed for voice services. Whereas we have this very fast feedback control, 1 millisecond time to transmit interval. We have MIMO, all these different modulation schemes. And depending on where you are in the cell site and your signal to noise ratio, that'll determine your throughput. Frequencies, we talked about that. Modulation, LMR is fixed at basically 2 bits per symbol modulation, whereas LTE deploys up to 8 bits per modulation, and it's dynamic based upon where you are on the cell site, so it's not fixed. The area where LMR and LTE really differentiate each other is in multicast and unicast. So LMR is primarily multicast. You're talking one to many. You're talking to a talk group, typically, or channel with a lot of people listening in on that channel. So occasionally it'll be broadcast one to one, but unicast. But most of the time it's one to many. Whereas it's just the opposite on LTE. It's one to one all the time. Very few times will it be one to many. The EMBMS protocol can't support that. I would say this though, on a normal, and whatever a normal is, typical cell site sector in 10 megahertz of spectrum, which is what public safety has, 10 by 10 megahertz allocation, you can support, you know, about 400 simultaneous users per sector. So if you have 3 sectors in a cell site, 1,200 users on that cell site. If you exceed that, obviously one-to-many becomes an issue. You need to do that. It's not the most efficient way, but LTE has a great amount for capacity for a number of users, and the call setup is very short. So for public safety and a dedicated network, the use of EMBMS may not be necessary in a lot of circumstances. In urban areas and crowded areas, yes, I would say that makes sense. What becomes an issue with doing broadcast services on LTE is that you have to dedicate
between 10% and 60% of your spectrum all the time has to be dedicated to broadcast services. So at best, I'll only have 90% of my system available at any one time. That 10% has to be reserved for broadcast communications. But that's a network planning issue, and that'll be determined, you know, on a case-by-case basis around the country, I'm sure. Low latency, we talked about that. Mouth to ear is typically less than 350 milliseconds on a front radio system. That's about the maximum that you can have. So once you get beyond, let's say, about 330 milliseconds, your ear to mouth, you start noticing yourself talking over yourself. So if you've ever been on an international call and you're maybe talking over someone, once you get above 330 milliseconds, you start talking over yourself. So typically, this is 350 milliseconds on the trunk radio system. Devices, SU units are programmed via, you know, computer or vendor-specific hardware. So if you have a radio engineer here in this area, they typically have to get your radio physically in. They have to plug in the programming module, and they have to program up new channels, they put in a new security key, whatever that may be. Typically your device, your cell phone, you get an update pushed from Apple or someone else, and you get that, and it's self-installed. You say, oh, I just need to install. I do it, and it's self-installed over the air, over the network. Security, P25 does offer 256-bit encryption. What's interesting is that it offers that, but not everyone buys that. So many jurisdictions, for instance, in the metro area, some are on triple DES, some are on 128-bit, some are on 256-bit. And because they're all in different encryption and they have different encryption keys, they're not necessarily interoperable with each other. So even though public safety has this capability, they don't always necessarily deploy that the same across the network. We talked about mission critical push-to-talk and the standards there regarding that. So a little bit of a comparison. We talk about Adams County. Since that's in our state, it's a great comparison. So Adams County has both DTRS at the 700 megahertz band, and it has 700 megahertz LTE. And if you look at this, it's about a 16-to-1 ratio. So the red dots right here are the DTRS sites in this particular graphic, and the triangles are all 700 megahertz LTE sites. So for this given geographic area, that's they're getting the same amount of coverage out of the out of the LTE cell sites as they are out of the DTRS sites. But just because of the technology and the power and the way the systems are architected, LTE takes a lot more sites to cover the same geographic area. So this area, if you've been out to the DIA airport, so you have the city right here, you have Thornton, and you have North Denver and Aurora, so fairly urbanized suburban area. But then this is just, you know, basically flat, you know, farmland out here, similar to some of the valleys up here in the desert, maybe going farther south. Not a lot of mountains or anything of that nature, but big difference in number of sites. So this is more site leases, more antennas, backhaul that you have to pay for. So there's more costs involved with deploying that network. So you look at LMR, we have discrete channels that we set up to support each conversation. In LTE, we have this big data pipe. And so we can send our police, our medical, our messaging, PSAP, you name it, voice conversation, all get put into this data pipe. And they can get then given a different quality of service and bearers determine how much data throughput I need for that particular service. So I'll just push through. Is that okay? This is the last part right here. One of the things that we have done in the past year in working with Brian Shepard and his team and Ed and Kim is developing an RF network plan for the state of Colorado and what that looks like and taking in several different criteria. So when we ask the question, what's involved in coverage, there's kind of three parameters that we look at on what determines coverage. One is, what's your data rate for the uplink, for me transmitting from my phone up to the network? So what's that data rate look like? What's my downlink data rate? So that's one metric we look at. The other one is the probability of coverage. So what are the chances of me, the probability within the distribution curve of me getting coverage within a given geographic area? So if I have a 95% chance or 80% chance of getting coverage in that area. And then the venue that I'm in. So So not just looking at, this is a geographic area, and you have a 90% coverage availability in here. What does it look like if I'm in a building, in a vehicle, or out on the street with my cell phone? Because that's different. You walk into a building, your signal goes down, you maybe don't have coverage. So all of you have probably walked into a commercial cell phone store and seen the little maps that they have. You see the blue map from one carrier, the pink map, the yellow map, and the red map. And those maps don't always match up with necessarily where the coverage is, per se. Sometimes they're better than others. But anyway, all three of these dimensions are what we include in coverage. So in building coverage, a really good macro network typically is designed to cover a high percentage of the buildings on the outside. And then because they have such a high density of cell sites, it penetrates. First wall penetration is usually considered in that coverage plan. And it's typically, you know, 2 to 3 story buildings and less. It doesn't include elevator shafts and parking garages, typically in the cellular, commercial cellular network. But those are then supplemented by DAS or distributed antenna systems in building repeaters, et cetera. We don't know what this relationship will look like with FirstNet, so this in building and how deep in building that goes is to be determined. So if you have buildings here in the city that are covered, let's say, beyond second wall coverage, does that need to have an in-building solution put in there for public safety? And then Wi-Fi, what's the Wi-Fi support? So for instance, there's Wi-Fi, you know, right here that's provided by the department. Should FirstNet be able to tie into that if you have your cell phone? Should it automatically roam then onto that Wi-Fi network? And then how does that get integrated in? So those are all part of what get considered in our solution. So looking at that, what type of infrastructure then needs to get deployed in order for you to meet those coverage requirements? So if we look at day-to-day use, and so in cities and suburban areas, a dedicated public safety system has some utility, but a commercial network probably kind of meets that 80-20 rule. Probably for 80% of your needs on a typical day, it probably meet your needs. But special events, skiing here, you know, the festival that you're going to have on the river, etc., you may have a large amount of people congregated in a concentrated area, a dedicated public safety system or deployable network may be required for that or likely for that. Same with localized incidents. Commercial network probably has some incident, but you really need a dedicated public safety and probably a deployable system to give you specific coverage for that. For wildfires in this area or tornadoes or avalanches, again, having dedicated public safety network, and then remote areas, which is a lot here, you have dedicated and deployable systems are likely your most and probably best effort there for getting coverage. Looking at the depth of coverage, we have in-building coverage here, and so we look at in-building coverage, and we can cover it in a dense urban, suburban, rural, cluttered. Our data rates that we need to cover, so we want to do 640 kilobits per second on the downlink and 64 kilobits on the uplink. Yeah, that doesn't sound very fast. You were talking about gigabits before. Well, this is, on average, per device, at a 90% probability in building. So I'm in a building and I have a 9 out of 10 chance of getting this minimum data rate here. That means the majority of the time I have a much higher data rate outside of the system. So in for rooftop mounted vehicles, this is a patrol car or a vehicle, suburban, whatever it may be, driving out in the area. With driving through rural open or rural clutter and suburban, which would be most of the morphology here in Gunston, I'm going to give each user 10 megabits per second on the downlink and a megabit on the uplink and offer them Wi-Fi. And that data rate will likely be much higher on average, but this is to cover that geographic area. So let's see what that looks like going forward. So here's some other assumptions. So on the top here, we have dense urban. So Denver is considered dense urban in just a very small portion of it. The rest of it is considered urban. And then suburban are typically, you know, 3-story or 4-story buildings and less. And then you have rural clutter, which is a lot of the area. You maybe have a couple houses or a school out here or something along that nature. And then rural open is just wilderness areas. Each one of these are a margin in dBs that we give for our normal log fading and indoor penetration, vehicular penetration, the gain from the antennas that we get, the body loss, because when you put your phone up to your head, some heads are thicker than others, but we just gave everyone the same amount of loss, and then the transmit power. So then we have assumptions per venue. So in an indoor situation, you may say, ah, yes, I need to put my in-building penetration on there. Well, for outdoors, no, there's no in-building penetration. So when we put all these numbers into our calculations, we make sure we're not double counting things and overbuilding the network, because now you can add a lot more cell sites to a situation that adds more cost and complexity to the network. So all these different parameters get added in. And so this is a picture of the state of Colorado. And each one of these dots represents a 1 mile by 1 mile grid. And the counties are put in there. This was the map that was proposed by FirstNet and the coverage they are going to offer the state. So if I look at Gunnison, which is right here. So if you look at Gunnison, everywhere that there is a block here is where there's coverage. Everywhere there's white, there's no coverage. So this is what was proposed by FirstNet. That probably looks similar to what a commercial carrier might have, maybe even worse than what a commercial carrier has. So you see great coverage here in the urban Front Range area, not so much here in the rest of the state. So when we looked at the FirstNet specification, when we broke it apart, we looked at, wow, they cover almost 98% of the population. That's great. They only covered 24% or 23.7% of the geographic area. When we talked to public safety, you and others, that was unacceptable on any level, even in the urban areas, that's just not acceptable going forward. So if you look at the first, and this is FirstNet, what they propose. This is a little bit of a eye chart, but if you look here, let's see, at Gunnison, they cover 88.4% of the population. Not bad. Only 18% of your land area had any coverage here in Gunnison. That's not a lot. That's probably less than your DTRS system. But maybe that's indicative of your commercial cellular carriers. I don't know. What would you say? That
I would say it is, indicative of commercial.
Yeah. So they cover maybe 50 here, go up to Crested Butte.
35.
Yep, and that's about it.
35.
Yep. Yep.
Maybe a little
Taylor
Canyon.
Yeah. And that's about it. So you look at this, and that's, you know, a lot of the states like that. You look at some counties, they're even worse, you know, in coverage. Or you take some counties that are surrounded in an urban area like Broomfield, which is a really tiny county. Well, they have 100% coverage. You know, so they're happy with that plan. So on average, you say, well, hey, we're covering 97.73% of the population. That's great. But for you in your area, that doesn't work. So the state of Colorado said, we don't like this. We want to come up with our plan. First, I said, come up with an alternative plan and give it to us. So that's what we did. So we looked at what needs to be covered. We looked at the FirstNet provided set of data, and then we got from the state of Colorado a lot of other information. And what we did is we mapped out, consistent with FirstNet, 1 by 1 mile grids. And we said, okay, if there's an area that needs to be covered and it passes through that grid, we're going to flip that on and we're going to provide coverage there. So we talked to you and you told us this is where we want to provide coverage. So surveys were sent out and they said, okay, this is where we're going to do it. So if a road passed through at a city, we turned that grid on and then we were going to place a site there. So in the next set of pages, we're going to take a look at what the geographic coverage looks like and the depth of coverage based upon the requirements that we put together in comparison to FirstNet. So taking all the data sources together, DTRS coverage, what you wanted as users, everything in orange here is what you want covered as a user. So that's a little bit different than the FirstNet map. So anything in white is basically a mountaintop. So you look here in Gunnison, most of your county is covered. So these are, you know, some peaks here, mountains, and maybe some valleys that aren't covered, but for the most part, really good coverage. So in our model, The slides I'm going to show you, I've updated these, are from, we did eight, we're on study number eight, but we've done eight different iterations of doing network deployment. So the first one is, we said, let's look at coverage only, and we're going to, all of our sites in our first three studies are going to be non-commercial sites. So the state of Colorado gave us access to a database that had all the common areas of interest. So these could be buildings like this, school buildings, any government-owned building or tower or site. We said, well, we're going to use that and place cell sites on there. So there are over 7,000 of those buildings and sites in that database. And so that's what we did in the first three studies, is we iterated that and looked how that would look like, a network like that. Then we said, let's do it unconstrained. So this is when you just go nuts and say, forget about leases or where buildings are. I'm just going to place a site no matter what to give me the coverage I want. And then we did this. Let's do 100% of the geography. Let's cover 100% of the state. And then in this study, we said, okay, let's look at just commercial sites. What do commercial operators have now? And let's use their site. So looking at all the different commercial operators, we grabbed, I think, I don't know, 40 different databases and merged them together of all the different tower locations available commercially, and we deployed that. Now, in this study right here, you're going to see a synthesis of all that put together and what that looks like. So, in that, we said there were 850 commercial sites that we're going to use for a build-out. 475 sites are of commercial area interest, buildings like this, public safety buildings. And then we had about 22 handpicked sites to add coverage, in, mainly in dense urban areas. We had to kind of place those manually. And then we had 112 sites to fill in areas not covered. So these are basically new cell sites that there weren't sites available to provide coverage in rural areas. So our design has 1,459 sites to cover the state of Colorado. It's a lot, but that's to get you where you guys want to go. So this provides coverage with a reasonable number of sites. So looking at that, this is a color code, and this is looking at the downlink. This is data rate I'm getting from a downlink. I'm watching a video or downloading it. So in red, it's 40 megabits per second, and then going down, and then voice coverage is in blue. Green is 1 megabit per second. So these are the assumptions on here. We're assuming 75 megabits per second. The calculation we ran through before, that's what we're using as a peak data rate for a different morphology. So let's take a look at what the map looks like. So looking at a map, here's the data rate chart right here. Here's Gunnison. You have 40 megabits per second in a lot of the area here. In most of the state, you're getting at least 1 megabit per second. So in the yellow and green areas here, you're getting really good data rates in a lot of the areas of the county here in our design. Where you had no coverage before, you're at least getting some. And just to give you a perspective, so a megabit or 1,000 bits per second is what that green is. It's greater than that. You need for a voice call, for a high quality HD voice call, you need about 64 kilobits. So you're getting 1,000 of those. So you have more than enough here to have talkback and at least basic voice connectivity. And this would get you, you know, a megabit per second, you can download web pages and get content. So that's what the coverage looks like on the downlink side. And that's in building coverage. We look at the in-vehicle, this is in-vehicle. So this is in-building, what the data rate looks like. In-vehicle, it's a little different. You see, I don't know if you see the shade change here, if you're looking at Gunnison. So in vehicle, we're getting a little bit more loss, but this coverage is still really good. Now, if you look outdoors, this is when you're standing outdoors of the vehicle and you have that maybe handheld Sonom device. This is the data rate you're getting. Well, now I'm getting pretty good data rate. I don't have the loss from the vehicle over me. And so here I'm getting, you know, 40 megabits, 25 megabits in a lot of the main areas. And then the outlying areas here, I'm still getting 5 to 1 megabit per second of downlink. Now if we look with a rooftop antenna, this is, so I'm in my vehicle, I have a rooftop antenna, I have that router hooked in,
these are the data rates I'm getting. So I've increased my coverage here. I'm getting higher data rates, more availability in the network. You see now, most of my 1 megabit area is gone. Now I'm at the 5 to 10 megabit area in the majority of the county here. So your data rate's going up now. And now with the high-power amplifier, it's even a little bit better. Now with high-power amplifier in some of these areas over here, I'm getting up to 40 megabits per second in some of these areas. So considerably improved from getting no coverage to getting broadband connectivity in this area. And then with voice connectivity, basically we cover the entire state, you can get voice connectivity. And now with mission critical push to talk. So that's the intent. That was the impetus of this design was to get to this point. So now if we take a look at the coverage for Gunnison. Right here. So Gunnison is right here. So we have basically, let's see, right here. We're at 3,200 square miles. Population we used was 15,954. So the coverage that we offer now, indoor coverage, 81% indoor coverage, in vehicle, 87%. So outdoor coverage now, 96% of your county now has coverage. With a rooftop antenna or a high-power amplifier, so if you're in a vehicle, now you'll have 100% coverage over the entire county with that. So considerable amount of difference as opposed to 18.4% versus because they first had to do an apples-to-apples comparison was outdoors right here. So if you look at outdoors for Gunnison, 96% is what we covered here. FirstNet's original plan was 18.4%. So that's the difference in the approaches that we took for covering the state and for the county. And so we have all this available. All these slides are available, so you can look at them and show your people. So right now, FirstNet is getting all these offers back from different companies that are willing to build a network. We gave this information all to FirstNet. We said, the state, I'm speaking on behalf of them, said, this is what we want as a state. This is our bargaining chip, per se. You want to come to the state, you want to build coverage for us? This is what we want. So that has been given. It's not 100%, but it's close to it for this county. So much better than I think what you have now was available. So,
I don't know if you've already said this, you also talk about the time frame that they said 5 years and what the response was. Do you go into that later?
Yeah, I can talk about that. So the timeline for FirstNet is they're going to get they've gotten their bids already. They're evaluating them right now. They will make a decision by the end of this year, supposedly in November. When that hits, assuming there's no protest, and there's going to be a protest, assuming there's no protest, then they, being FirstNet, have 6 months to deliver a plan to the state of Colorado. That plan has to have how many sites they're going to build, where the coverage is going to be, and the time frame for that. So sometime in April of next year, and this would be the earliest this would happen, FirstNet will deliver plans to the state of Colorado. The governor then has 90 days to make a decision on whether they want the state to opt into that plan, say, yes, we're all in, let's go for it, or provide an alternative plan and build their own radio access network out. So 90 days to make that decision. Then the governor has another 120 days, I think it is, to come up with that alternative plan and give that then to FirstNet. So then you're talking the end of next year, that the state that has to come up with their own plan, which we've already done, so we're ahead of the game here, and give that as an alternative plan. FirstNet has put together a 5-year build plan from the time that the contract is awarded in November until they build out their entire network to get their coverage. So what we're saying is we don't want your coverage scheme, we want ours that we developed. And we want that in less than that time frame. So we would like to see that compressed to a 3-year schedule as opposed to a five-year schedule. But when that happens, likely that timeframe happens sometime at the end of next year, 2017, 3 years from now, so that's like a 2020 timeframe, likely to get that built out. So that's just kind of setting expectations, as opposed to FirstNet, which would be a 2022 timeframe, and maybe not the coverage anymore. So that's why we want people to get, it seems like it's far off, but now is the time to do a course correction for FirstNet and their offer and say, hey, this is what we want. This is the service that we want. This is how we think we can accomplish it.
So the question is, do we want to have access to that network and how much does it cost?
Exactly. So you have no idea how much, can't answer it, can't answer it.
Yeah. But if you want to use our fiber network to tie into this somehow, I think there's got to be some give and take on both sides.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
We have a question from the internet. Will the technology of the end-user radios need to be changed or updated to work on the LTE system?
So will, I'll just repeat it here so again. So will the technology in the radios need to be changed in order to use LTE technology? Well, your, by radios, I'm assuming they mean their DTRS or land mobile radio network radios. They are not compatible with LTE. Your smartphone that you have, if you have a modern smartphone, it likely has LTE technology in it. That will be the type of device that you'll get, or the sound device. I don't know if we have a picture of it, but no. So the quick answer is no. Now, at the conference, at the XPS LTE conference that was held by the state here about a month ago or so, two companies were there, Motorola and Harris, and they showed off devices, and I don't know if some of those slides are available or not, but they had devices there that had LTE and LMR built into the same physical device. So a potential technology refresh of LMR radios could include LTE technology in it.
Yeah, and just to the point that Emo was making, at the XPS LTE, we are creating an entire page. So if you weren't able to go to the event, you'll be able to go to this page. You'll be able to see videos. Every one of the companies, there were 20 companies that participated. You'll be able to get a real high-level Reader's Digest version of what their technology does. And then there will be, you'll get to see if they had a if they had a PowerPoint presentation or other, you know, data sheets, or you'll be able to get all that. And so we should have that up in the next week or so to where you'll be able to access all that. We are actually building it this week.
Right. So just to round this up, so in-vehicle, so the different indoors, in-vehicle, outdoors, rooftop with a high-powered amplifier. The blue bar is the area population. So indoors on a state level, 95% of the state is covered indoors, population-wise, 99%. If you look at outdoors, so this is the FirstNet comparison, this middle one, 99% of the area is covered and 100% of the population, as opposed to FirstNet, which was 97.3% of the population and 25% of the area. So big difference in a network deployment strategy. And then this is the disclaimers. I have to show this, saying that this was funded by NTIA, but these are our own opinions and so forth and so on. But that concludes the training session. But any other questions with regards to deployment and coverage?
No.
You can ask anything. It's fine.
No, I don't have to ask anything. I have to start asking something.
We're open to sarcastic comments.
Well, you know, we're against it. Things just don't happen here.
And yeah.
We do it 10 to 15, 20 years beyond when the projections are, which are all great. And obviously, the extra coverage would be wonderful, but we don't have a population base. We do have the visitors that come. They're certainly within those corridors. And most of course, they get on their four-wheelers and go up and sit. I don't realistically see this actually being executed in your time. Lovely theory, but I
would. Not my time frame.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm just reporting it. You know, that's healthy skepticism, though.
I mean, I get it. Yeah. The theory is great. I know that Korea has, I have some friends where they're teaching, and they have a nationwide wireless, they think it's the right of the citizens to be able to access, you know, that.
Right.
And obviously, we are doing that. We have a lot more commercial interest here.
Right.
So that's driving more than public safety or, you know, public safety, private safety, that's going to be driving.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Now, if FirstNet can hold the offer to their build plan, then by requirement, they have to meet build timeframe. So in the first year, it's 20%, then it jumps up to 60% of the rural coverage, and then 80% and then 100% over that time, five-year timeframe. Starting in the second year, it starts to accelerate up. That's the intent to provide that. Now, coverage doesn't always have to be provided by terrestrial physical cell sites in the ground. There are alternative solutions. So you look at what Google is trying to do by space data. So they use weather balloons and provide, you know, coverage over a wide area. Some of the drone coverage that can be provided by drones that I talked about, aerostats or blimps, fixed-wing aircraft. There's alternative solutions that can be deployed for rural areas that are getting more and more cost effective. So the ability to get that technology quicker and faster over a wider area is possible. Now, whether or not they're going to make an investment in this area, that's where your voice needs to be made. And I think, you know, the state hears it. But if you want access into FirstNet or contacts there, we're happy, you know, to provide that. Because I think the more that they hear from the rural communities, because when you look at FirstNet's map, everything east of the Mississippi is very well covered. So, and that's because you have more dense population centers. The geography tends to lend itself to better coverage characteristics. Whereas you get west of the Mississippi and you hit the square states out west here, it's very difficult. You look at the Montana, the Wyoming, Dakotas, New Mexico, Arizona, even California. You look at California beyond the coast, you go to Northern California or out to the desert and the oil lands there, not a lot of coverage out there. But there's a tremendous need for public safety to provide services out there because you have a lot of recreational activities happening there. You still have to get hikers out and people that are stranded and wilderness and fires. So I think that has been a difficult thing for carriers to understand because they come in from the mentality, well, I'm not generating revenue off
that. Yeah, I understand.
Yeah. So that's where getting your voice heard by them, the more you can do that, the better.
And let me just say a word to that, too. We actually understand that, and we actually encourage the skepticism from the state of Colorado, because as one person who has traveled all 64 counties, and I have been to both of the tribes, and we've been there multiple occasions, we've heard the pain. No matter where we're at, we get the laughs, or they never get here. They don't provide what they promised. And so, yes, we are dealing with the feds, and yes, you are dealing with us from the state, and there are always going to be things that are going to be beyond our control, but you will actually find, if you delve into this deeper, that, as Emil was talking about, they can monetize the spectrum in Denver. This ought to be really easy to build out in places like Denver and those huge population centers. And so if you look at our strategy in depth, what we've done is we've said, we're not even going to worry about that because for them to monetize the spectrum, they have to build it out. What we want to be concerned about is the folks out in Gunnison County or the people out in Durango, and we want the resources put there. Again, there are certain things that we can't control. It's beyond our capabilities in some of it, but we have your best interest at heart, and there are some other ways you can get involved. Everything that we've talked about here, we have the extensive training on our website at firstnetcolorado.org. We actually go into a real in-depth discussion of this. We've set up some teams where we have a business working group where if you have folks from within the community that actually have some business acumen and can help us, because we have to put this together. Should it be run by the state? Should it be run by a third-party organization? How should this be put together? We also have a
an operational working group of, let's get all the operational folks in there. What kind of things do they need? How does this thing need to work? And when they push certain buttons, what should it do? And then the other one is a technical working group. And that technical working group are folks that come together and reason, how does this thing get pieced together? And then we do have a legal working group, because our state, being a state that is a home rule, local rule, what are all the multiple implications there? So there are ways for you to get involved. Our governing body meetings occur every month. They are open. We want you to be a part of that as well, and you know, listen in and keep us accountable. So I'll end it with that, but we do. We actually, from the very beginning, we said we want you to be critical, because we understand we're dealing with the Fed, you're dealing with the state, and we really want this. For this to make any sense, it has to be better than what we have presently. And we have to, we have to learn from the past. And the past mistakes are what has happened with some of our other systems. And I'll shut up with that one.
No, that's good. If we as a state, city, county, tribal level, remain quiet, you get what you ask for. If you don't ask for anything, this is what FirstNet has proposed. This is what will be built as a minimum requirement. So if that voice is not heard, and we made our voice heard, and we told them, this is what we want for coverage. But that needs to be backed up now, consistently. I know it seems like it's a long ways off, but if we don't do it now, that money that's been allocated by Congress to build this out will get put towards something that is unacceptable for most of the counties in Colorado. So with that, I'll end and give you guys 10 minutes back to your time.
Yes, thank you again from the state of Colorado. We appreciate your time and your participation, and have a great day. Talk to you later.
Thank you.